gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It'll be fine on the mountain.
It's time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Built by the Barnuminium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chiefs Sports Network.
Juice wells all the way, touchdown Gamecocks.
Pressure, and he just dives in.
All right, greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home. Inside the Gamecocks, the show live from the Signorama Studios, the preferred sign partner of the Gamecocks and built by the BarnDominiumCo.com, where you can build your dream home for as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, if you live in Georgia, or if you live in Tennessee, we also, of course, are served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and it is some fine bourbon. If you haven't had it, make sure you just check out our app, and you can click on the Chicken Cock Challenge button, and you'll be able to find it in a location near you. JC will be along in just a moment. I'm JB. He's Phil. We're here until 2 o'clock this afternoon. Coming up in about 15 or so minutes, John Whittle with the Big Spur will join us to react to this weekend's loss in College Station. The Gamecocks now just 2-6 on the year, but home for the entire month of November. Plenty on that today in our program and throughout the week. We'll also be joined at noon, as always on Mondays, by the great Pat DiMarco, coming home from his trip to Buffalo late last week to go watch the Bills play where he once played in the NFL. And we'll get through some video with him pertaining to the ball game this past weekend. South Carolina up next. It's the Gamecocks of Jacksonville State at noon on ESPNU. But if you will be in Columbia for that on Saturday, we'll be honoring at halftime and recognizing the greatest era in the history of the program, 2010 through 2013, Steve Spurrier, amongst all of those who will be there. I mentioned Pat DiMarco earlier, Steven Garcia, and so many more from that era, Connor Shaw. They'll step out onto the field and allow a what will be raucous round of applause for that fine group of gentlemen that represented South Carolina so well. We'll also take a drive around the SEC, brought to you by Love Chevy. We'll look at the rest of the country. Clemson also loses this weekend again. It's shaping up to be a November of who wants to bowl and who doesn't when they get to that game, the final one on Thanksgiving weekend. The college football playoff rankings come out this week. We'll get into the World Series a little bit, and we certainly will take your questions, concerns, comments, and the whole nine yards in the NanoSports chat box. And if you're out cruising around listening or watching our program, you can just text 803-766-6320. Phil, good morning.
Morning, sir. Good morning. We've made it through the weekend unscathed.
Yeah.
At least personally. Football team can't say so much. But, hey, this is, you know, like you said, we got four home games coming up. This team plays better at home than they do on the road. That's quite evident. I hate that one road win or a win away from home, not just on the road, but even neutral site. You got a chance starting this week, put together the season that you can remember.
Yeah, there's no question. You know, they've got a lot. There's still actually a lot on the line, and I cannot remember. Well, not that I can't remember. I can remember. It's never been like this before, where they've got four home games in the month of November. I think they're the only team in college football, as a matter of fact, who will stay home the entire time. And on top of that, all four of those games are all very winnable. And you just never really know how a season is going to play itself out. Only a few weeks ago, you know, you kind of thought, well, shoot, that Kentucky game, that's going to be, that might be a, and it's not that it won't be difficult. It will be difficult. I'm not saying that it won't, but it certainly doesn't look like it once did. We'll talk about the Wildcats today. They do this from time to time. They beat up on a bunch of no names early in the year, and then they fall apart when the better competition comes along, which has once again happened. And then, of course, you know, I'm not sure that many out there predicted, if any, that the Tigers would be where they are. So at least you looked at the back end of the November schedule and you thought, no, well, they'll take care of Jacksonville State, or they should. They'll take care of Vanderbilt, or they should. And then those two games will be very difficult. Again, those two games are going to be very difficult, but they just still don't hold the, you know, that aura that they once did. And so, you know, generally this is September. Like, generally, not always, but generally programs have the lighter part of their schedule up front so they can stack up some wins and get some young guys in there and get them working and get the confidence flowing, get everybody kind of on the same page. And then, you know, you got your battles coming up, and we'll see how it all works itself out. Totally the opposite for South Carolina. Absolutely 100% the opposite direction, where they've got now, they're not going to leave the house, and they've got they got four games that they'll be favored in two of them. The other two, if they're not favored, they'll be very small underdogs more than likely, and have a great chance to finish at 500, which, if they can do that, Phil, if they can do that, nobody wakes up and says, gosh, I just hope my football team goes 6-6 in the regular season this year. Nobody does that. And I get that. And those are very low expectations. But to go from 2-6 to there, capping the season off with a win, your second consecutive over the Wildcats, it would kind of feel like all is right in the world again. Your second consecutive over Clemson, it would kind of feel like all is right in the world again. I don't know that you'd really look back and go, well, that season was a success, but you would also, it's like saving par. You know, it's like saving par or bogeying when you're like, oh God, we're if I don't get this thing out of the bunker here, you're staring at a triple. You know, and
you're in the bunker. Yeah.
You get it out, you got a little 8-footer, you knock it in, and you breathe, and you walk off the green, and you get in your cart to go to the next hole, and your mind is clear. And the next hole in this case, of course, would be a bowl game. So I mean, it's doable, and it's something that you know, I think this program expects to do with what lies ahead.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you've got everything in front of you. I think the one game you really have circled is the next one, right? I mean, and, you know, I know that's kind of cliche or whatever, but it was like, okay, your season, you know, depends on this game. Bad Carolina teams lose this game on Saturday. And so you need to come out and win this game. And you need to just roll on, because you've got Vanderbilt, which is, you've got what, an 11 game winning streak against right now, 10 or 11. Yeah. And you don't want to drop that. You can't have that, you know, can't have that flip on you this year. And then, you know, the winnable games of Kentucky and, you know, what, and who would have thought it at the beginning of the season, you could have a Clemson team roll in, who is also looking for their sixth win.
Right.
So I don't know if that's the way you really want it to play out, but hey, you know, nothing like getting full eligibility by the state.
There's no doubt. There's just so much that goes into this whole season too. There are so many different conversations to be had. I will say this, with all of the injuries that Carolina has succumbed to, with all of them, the offensive line problems, the whole nine yards, this is just my opinion and my opinion only. I don't know. You could probably say the Florida game, maybe. Maybe I can't see it with Georgia. But just hindsight being 2020, I don't know that you can point to any of the six losses, maybe with the exception of one, that says, had we been healthier, we would have won. And I know that sounds fairly negative, but I believe that it's true. I mean, the first game of the year, they were without, you know, a couple guys up front, but mostly pretty healthy. And it, of course, they were without Juice. But, you know, I if Juice was there, I'm not sure that Rattler still doesn't get sacked as much as he did. Maybe a little bit less. I don't know. It's hard to imagine, even though they played the game closely. Well, actually, they were better than Georgia for two quarters, which is still kind of astonishing when you look back on it. Georgia was still kind of trying to find their feet. Got dominated in the second half. With Juice in that game for its entirety, could it be different? Maybe it could. Tennessee, it's hard to see it, right? It's hard to see it in Missouri. I mean, it's even hard to – I mean, so, I don't know. Maybe there is a win or two in there without as many injuries as they've had. There might be. I don't personally think that there's a more than one if there was. So at this point in time, you'd still be at 3-5 or maybe 4-4 or something like that. Now, you also would have, you know, I think 4-4 was ideal getting to November because you knew you'd have a great chance to finish with three or four wins, and that's a nice year. That's a great year, as a matter of fact. That one or two wins makes all the difference in the world. You know, so there's a lot of things that they've got to kind of get figured out sooner than later. November, again, will present a bunch of opportunities to do so. I saw somebody just a little while ago in the chat box, Joel, I said, what evidence do you have that the Gamecocks can handle Vandy? Well, I think Vandy's presented their own evidence, number one. Number two, I didn't say that. I said you should be able to handle Vandy. You should be able to handle Jacksonville State. I didn't say that they would. So let's not, I know Joel likes to get in here and ruffle feathers. Let's not do that because that's not what I said. So, you know, but they should. They should. Vanderbilt's not good. They're terrible. And they've lost, what is it now, Phil? Seven straight games since opening the season 2-0 over Hawaii and Alabama A&M. So absolutely, but South Carolina should handle these next two games. They should.
And yeah, then Vanderbilt will come in here outmatched. I mean, there's no, you know, two ways about it. You just have to handle it. I mean, you know, there's been times when Carolina looked like the better team on paper and has still dropped that game. So you just can't do that.
Right.
You can't have another Florida situation where it was like, you know, yeah, everybody's kind of picking you to win. You get the edge and then you just lay an egg because there's no room for eggs at this point, period. I mean, you know, if you're going to pull this season together, it's going to have to be four straight wins, which is a great way to, you know, end this ride. But, you know, it was like Jan said, out of the four, one hiccup, and it's not a good ending. I mean, you've played yourself to that point.
Yeah, I think you know, if you want to make the bold statements, you know, you can't lose either one of the next two. Those are not bad losses. Those are incredibly ridiculously embarrassing losses. Those are the losses. If you get beat by Kentucky and you get beat by Clemson or one of the other, those losses don't really set your program back a bit. They're hard for the fans to swallow. They're hard for the team to swallow. But those aren't losses that set your program back. Losses that set your program back are embarrassingly bad losses, like what could happen this weekend or versus Vanderbilt too. That's what sets your program back. That's where you dig that hole and you're standing on people's shoulders trying to get out of it. That's how deep it is. So you don't lose those. So I think, you know, if Carolina were to finish under 500, which there's a great possibility they can because they have to go 4-0 in order to not do that in the regular season, the best case scenario is that you win the next two and then you beat Clemson because everybody always celebrates beating their rival. We've already discussed round and round and round what the best case scenario is. That's winning all four of them. You know, anything less than that, it would be a difficult offseason, to put that lightly.
Yeah. There's going to be, talk about, you know, wailing and gnashing of teeth.
Yeah. Now, I mean, hey, look, if you want to dream a little bit, I mean, you know, here you are, whatever this person's name is in the Nana Sports chat box, walk-on long snapper, Carolina versus Clemson, both teams 5-6. That would be an intense game. It's very mid-1990s again, you know, right. A game like that with these two teams. but I mean, like, yeah, like if you want to bring some type of intrigue and suspense back into your year, like you're sitting at 2-6. Every fan in this fan base is sitting here going, golly, please get us to Thanksgiving weekend where we have a chance to at least get to a bowl game, but also in the same breath say we get to keep our rivals at home. Like, yeah. That is that there. And that's another part of this. We're going to talk about this today with JC. Like, you know, that's another part of this whole thing. You look to the upstate, and they're not that good. Like, they're not good. Clemson's 4-4, and you're 2-6. And you're really a couple of boneheaded plays away from being 3-5. So a couple of programs that have had just not a good year. If Clemson was 8-0, it'd be even a lot louder around here.
Yeah,
but they're not.
Yeah.
They're not. They're 4-4. And so, like, you know, there are not that people are satisfied in any way, shape, or form or giving a pass to be at 2-6, but there is a piece of the feeling of the fan base that when the rival isn't worth a damn either, that like it at least tames some of the animosity. And then, you know, you kind of let it all out, whatever happens in the game at the end of the year. So, yeah, that could be something. If both of them are sitting there at 5-6, whoever wins goes to a bowl game, and the other one has to stay home the rest of the offseason, that would be very traditional Palmetto State football as of like 30 years ago. Thought we'd move past that point at one point in time, but we're kind of right back where we were back in the 90s. So. All right, we do need to step aside. John Whittle is waiting patiently to jump in and fuss and discuss with us. Gamecock Baseball, of course, is practicing this fall. They've been hitting the ball a long way out of the yard over there at Founders Park. We'll see if he can squeeze in a little update on that as well. We are powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston. I saw a screenshot this morning. Somebody who's a fan of our program, who's in here often in the Nana's chat box often, went in and saw Michelle and bought a really, really cool electric bike. Really appreciate that. Michelle's a great client, but a better friend, and honored to call her that, and glad we've been able to work out all these deals over the last few months with them, and we'll continue to do so going forward. But really appreciate those who support our clients here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show, and on the Chief Sports Network. Hang tight, John Whittle, when we return.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome to Palm Casual Patio Furniture. Because we are the factory, Palm Casual has the ability to offer the highest quality outdoor furniture paired with world-class service. Since 1979, our factory showrooms have done our best to make the buying process as easy as possible for our customers. Our understanding of the many factors that go into your decision has helped us create our 30-day trial period that increases the level of comfort our customers feel during the shopping experience. Visit us in Somerville and online at palmcasual.com. Gamecock owned and operated.
Michael Campbell arrived at South Carolina in 2003 after growing up in Virginia and was dubbed the Winchester Rifle by Gamecocks great Tommy Moody in the broadcast booth. He left in 2006 a legend, a career 315 hitter and 20th round draft pick of the San Diego Padres. Campbell was first all-time in games played at bats and triples, second all-time in hits with 299, singles and total bases, third all-time in doubles, top 10 in runs scored and RBI, and he hit 31 home runs in his career for the Gamecocks. Now he's passing his knowledge to the next generation through his business, Soup's Swing Shop. If your son or daughter wants to improve their game, Soup's Swing Shop offers virtual lessons. Mike will connect with you, diagnose your swing, and create a special game plan to help improve it. Call him at 859-414-8240. Email soupsswingshop@gmail.com or find them on social media and on the Chief Sports app. Soup's Swing Shop. Play ball.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barn Dough Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Dough Company. Gamecock, owned and operated.
All right, 11:24. Welcome back inside the Gamecocks, the show here on the Chief Sports Network and always on the Chief Sports app. The great John Whittle joining us as he does on Mondays. What's up, man?
It's good to see you guys. Appreciate y'all having me. I lost my, I didn't lose it. I just don't know where it is. My Chief app hat.
It's okay.
So not wearing that today, but.
I
got it right down there in my little what you call it thing.
John, I lost mine too, so it's all good. And I, you know, it's my company, so you know, I don't have anything that even says anything on it. I was looking around thinking about that the other day, like maybe we should get some stuff ordered around here.
Yeah,
but that's all right. All right, man. Certainly want to get to some baseball with you. I want to talk about the World Series too. A couple of guys, you know, facing off. That was pretty neat on Saturday night. But we. Of course, we'll start with football. Gamecocks fall again, their fourth straight loss, Tennessee, Florida, Missouri, and now Texas A&M. Another game. Although the defense did some nice things here and there, they still had some just really brutal third downs where they couldn't get A&M stopped. Fourth downs. I'm pretty sure I haven't gone to confirm this number, but I was adding them up as the game went along. I'm pretty sure, John, that South Carolina's defense this year has given up 14 of 19 fourth down conversions.
That sounds right. It actually sounds a little low. You might
that
be
is
right.
Awful. That
you
is awful.
Might be right. Yeah. And they, Texas A&M had what, three of them in the first half, I think it was, and yeah. helped get a couple of touchdown drives out of it. Disappointing. Haven't been able to get off the field on third down or fourth down. Third down was okay a couple weeks ago against Florida. Fourth down's been the bugaboo here lately. So that's made it much more difficult on the defense, even though they did play better aside from about a little stretch there in the second quarter.
Yeah. There's 14 of 19. That is 74%. Oh my God. That is wow. I don't think I've ever seen that before in my life. And they're giving up 42% on third down, and a couple of those. We'll look at some of those coming up with Pat DiMarco in video. Yeah, look, it was going to be a tall task going over there. Let me ask you this. I don't know if this question's fair or not, but I answered my own question earlier. I think there might be one. If Carolina didn't have all these injuries, that includes Juice Wells, how many more wins would they actually have right now?
It's a fair question. I mean, you have to win a whole lot of offensive games because obviously they're not suffering a whole lot defensively from an injury standpoint. You know, I feel like you're going to be putting up a lot more points if you've got some healthy offensive linemen and a healthy Juice Wells. I mean, Juice Wells and Xavier Leggett on the field at the same time, which we've seen for what, like, I don't know, 20 plays this year, it feels like. Like, that's pretty formidable right there, especially when you have a quarterback who, especially early, was going like Spencer Rattler was. So, I don't know. I mean, I feel like you probably win a couple more games, just because your offense is so much better. You're scoring more points. Your defense isn't under pressure as much they'll just be a little bit better, I feel like. They won't be out there as much. So, I don't know. I haven't really sat down and thought of you know, what game would this make a difference? What game would it not have? You know, Texas A&M was going to be really tough anyway. I thought it was going to be a little bit more lopsided than it actually was and felt. Like, I thought South Carolina would lose by about 18 points or something like that, but I thought it would feel more like 30. And, you know, they lost by about 13, and, you know, I don't know that it felt like that much. So, I don't know. It's it would be certainly helpful from an offensive standpoint, but it's not like the defense has a bunch of guys out there either.
Yeah, I think that's what's been disappointing this year for me, is the defense. That's now 9 of 10 Power 5 games where they've given up 30 or more points. Certainly the offense contributes to that, you know, from time to time. I mean, this game, you start when it got under the, I think it was, what, the 4 or 5 minute mark in the second quarter, you were sitting there thinking, okay, all right, well, certainly if you can get a stop, you know, there's a chance you go into halftime. All right, so A&M scores. Okay, they score. Okay, so what? Just find a way to get this thing to halftime, because you get the ball to open the second half, and you've got some confidence. Just get this thing into halftime, take 15 minutes and regroup, and then come back out there, and then it just, you know, collapses on them in the last couple of minutes, and all of a sudden they're down 21-7, John. And I felt like as soon as that happened, it was not impossible, but coming back and really pulling a stunner on the road here just seemed – this team's fragile, and that seemed to kind of break the glass a little bit. It was just going to be hard to get out of that hole. Did you feel that way? What were you thinking in those moments when you went from, this is a good game, they're here, they've got a shot, to, oh my God, they're down 2 touchdowns in 3 minutes. How'd that even happen?
Yeah, when they went down 2 touchdowns, I thought it was going to be too difficult, especially with the way that last one happened. I mean, you have 4 plays with, you know, barely over a minute left, go -4 yards, hit a bad punt. You know, if you could have gotten in there 14-7, getting the ball back, I think you'd have been okay. You know, I'm not sure how fragile the team is, in my opinion. I just think that they're short in several ways. And, you know, they make mistakes. Maybe that's fragile. I don't know. But, you know, with the way that first half ended, I thought it was going to be really difficult to come back, just because I figured Texas A&M would make some adjustments after halftime and you know, do some things differently offensively. Clayton White was in – and the defense did okay for most of the first half and threw a couple of wrinkles out there at them. I thought they would make some adjustments and be a little bit better in the second half. They really weren't. So I thought it would kind of get away from South Carolina a little bit, but just wasn't enough. Just not quite good enough to overcome on the road.
Evaluate Spencer Rattler on the road versus at home.
It's hard. It's hard. Like, the numbers say how different he is at home versus on the road. But I don't know how much you really put in the opponents that you play on the road versus him actually being away from home. Like,
yeah,
they've played really, really good defenses on the road, and they've had some of their most adversity from an injury standpoint when they've been on the road. You know, Tree Babalade is out there playing left tackle, you know, midway through the second half, you know, barely on 1 foot. You know, they've had guys out and had to move guys around. They've had in-game stuff happen. I really don't know. I'm not sure how best to answer that question, just because the opponent's been so different in caliber on the road, and you know what he's had to deal with on the road has been so different. I mean, he didn't have Xavier Leggett most of the game against Missouri. He didn't have nearly anywhere close to 100% Xavier Leggett against Texas A&M. Like, his top target is a true freshman who had hardly played much, during the first half of the season. So it's really difficult to evaluate. I certainly don't want to put, you know, any kind of real blame on him. I don't feel like there's a whole lot that you can put on him just because of those reasons.
Well, and that was not a question to try to throw this dude under the bus in any way, shape, or form. And I think you answered it about how I thought you would, because there are things to consider. So South Carolina scores 41 points per game at home. They average 16 points per game on the road, but the level of competition that they've seen in both ballparks a little bit different. Mississippi State obviously isn't any good. Furman's an FCS team. And you had the Gators, who, when you look at everybody else that they've played outside of Mississippi State, are probably below all those other teams. And all those other teams have been played on the road. So I do think there's a component in that. You know, he continues to just – I don't know how – I can't even really go back and understand, John, how he ever got into a groove ever this year with the amount of issues they've had in protecting him. I mean, it is a – with all those injuries up there and playing the young guys, like, I don't think outside of 1999 probably, I guess 99, I've never seen an offensive line go through this. I actually think it probably should be worse than it is. But you've got talented guys, at least, that are freshmen that are having to play, and Trevon Baugh and Big Tree. So I think they're doing all they can. It is the strangest of circumstances I've ever seen for a kid as talented as Spencer Rattler.
Yeah, and, just go back. I mean, three of the top four defenses in the SEC, you know, South Carolina's played those teams on the road. Missouri's seventh in the SEC. So, you know, they're playing a in scoring defense. So, you know, they've played much better defenses on the road than at home. So, yeah, and I agree with you. I think it goes to Spencer Rattler's, you know, mindset, you know, his preparedness for each game, him having an understanding of what he has, what he doesn't have, and how to best manage, you know, what he's able to do out there. You know, he had a problem with not getting out of the pocket a little bit and have had some intentional groundings that were really costly. You know, he's heard the noise about the sacks. So I see what he was trying to do there. And Texas A&M's line is so fast and athletic. He wasn't able to get out of the pocket. So, you know, but I think he's got a great understanding of what he's trying to do, what he's capable of, and what the people around him are capable of. And I think that that's been a big key in his success.
JC joining us here at 11:35 on Inside the Gamecocks, coming off of his first program of the morning. JC and Morgan, guys, South Carolina this year has been outscored in the second quarter 89-57. What do you think the issue is?
It's a concern. I mean, from the North Carolina game on, it's been that way. Second quarter's not been kind to the Gamecocks, but I don't know. I mean, Saturday was a little bit a more of a field position kind of situation. And then Smith, I call it a recruiting touchdown because that dude's good. And he made a play kind of like a Juice Wells would have made a play. I'm not going to say there's nothing you can do about it, but it was just a great play on that part to get him to 21. But I don't know. I mean, I wish I had that answer. I think they're playing good football teams. I think if you look at the schedule right now, considering the injury situation, the Florida game is really the only one you feel like got away. I think the rest of them, I mean, you're not going to win any games. I mean, somebody in the chat box mentioned North Carolina was now a bad loss. That's not true, because teams go through different phases of the season. Maybe you play North Carolina now and they're not playing defense, you win a shootout, right? Well, they were playing defense then, okay? And teams change as the year goes on. So I think that, you know, playing good teams is a part of it. I think part of it is A&M adjusted to what Clayton White had a pretty good idea coming in with that new three-man front looking. I mean, it gave Texas A&M a lot of problems. The D line was getting. I mean, I haven't seen the D line get that kind of penetration all year. Have you guys? Really?
No. It's the first 3 minutes of the game was the best they've looked, but they were showing a lot of different looks too. Like you had that corner blitz by Dial.
Yeah.
You know, you had a lot of stuff going on there that you could tell was different. John, what do you have on that? Any insight as to what they decided to do this past week to try to generate more pressure defensively and create some issues?
Well, I mean, it seemed like they were trying to just throw a different wrinkle out there and get a couple of pass rushers out there. They've talked about how Javon Willis, the transfer from Ole Miss, who's, you know, hardly seen the field this year. I mean, regardless, I mean, not special teams, not defense, not anything, hardly seen the field at all, and threw him out there in some obvious pass rush situations and was able to get home and execute a few times. Brian Thomas Jr. Looked good out there, I thought. I thought he looked great, especially early on in the game and in those pass rush spots. And, you know, they let – I think JC pointed this out, but they let Tonka Hemingway, you know, kind of show a little bit more athleticism out there, let him play more of a big end kind of spot in the three-man front, and let him you know, show a little bit more athleticism out there. So, you know, I think it was just an effort to create some more negative plays and throw a different look out there that they hadn't used before.
Yeah, I you know, and you wonder what they'll do off of that moving forward. You know, will they continue to try to be a little bit more exotic? I mean, they're still not a very good defense. And boy, I will say this, it felt like, and there were a couple opportunities they just didn't get them. It felt like they were getting very close to getting a big turnover somewhere Saturday. I mean, you kept thinking it was coming. You know, they popped it early in the first quarter, or I'm sorry, it might have been late in the first quarter or early second quarter. Max Johnson came off field holding his rib cage. I said, well, I sure hope that kid's okay. You know, never wish injury on anybody. That's also a pretty good sign for the Gamecocks. You get one more good clip on him, and they might be down to their third-string quarterback, and wacky things start happening, you know. And but they never got him out of the game, and he started kind of – you could feel that a little bit later on. Remember, guys, they kind of started moving the football and juncture yardage. Felt like they had kind of figured out what South Carolina was doing defensively, and you just felt like it was going to be tough to go from there. But, yeah, just not enough bullets in the gun, guys.
Yeah, and to your point, Texas A&M has had problems with turnovers all year this year. Going into the game, they were tops in the SEC in the amount of times they turned the ball over. So, you know, I thought that South Carolina was going to have some opportunity in that area, and you know, there were some opportunities and just didn't take advantage of it. And you know, maybe that changes the game some. You know, failing to force a turnover, failing to block that punt in a scoop and score fashion, I mean, those things could have changed the game.
JC, four straight, JC and John, I haven't had a chance to speak with JC yet. Four straight here in November. They should be able to handle business this weekend. They should be able to handle business against Vanderbilt. Even with all the issues they've got, they're better than both those programs. And then it should come down to Kentucky and Clemson. We'll see how it all plays out. That's why you can never predict seasons, right? You can do all these little funny things, or you predict wins and losses and all that crap we do in July and August. None of it matters. Usually this is what you see in September. You know, guys, you know, I'll play a schedule that allows you to get some wins, i.e. Kentucky. And then, you know, you get that song and dance later on to try to figure out who the men are. Carolina gets that seemingly on the backside of this thing in November with these two up front. And then a couple of winnable games in Kentucky and Clemson, if all can go well for your program. I mean, with where they are now from an injury standpoint, from a confidence standpoint, just assess this overall entering this month with just two wins and the chance to get more.
I need to go back and look, but I don't think I can remember a season where we're going into November and South Carolina's played two SEC home games and three home games, period.
Yeah.
I don't think I can remember that. I think there's no secret this team plays better at home, the Florida loss notwithstanding. I think that they match up a lot better with Jacksonville State, Vandy, Kentucky, and Clemson than A&M and Missouri. And I'm not going to include Florida in that one because I do think they matched up pretty well with Florida, and I still don't think Florida's that good. I think that was a bad loss. But, you know, they match up better with these guys coming up than Tennessee and Georgia on the road, for God's sake. So I think the idea is flush everything, and I've got that today. And it's a new season. It's a new season starting Saturday. Jacksonville State not only could give the Gamecocks a game, they could win. Rich Rodriguez is a very good coach. His offense is tough to stop. They have a good running quarterback. They're not going to come in here scared. They're 7-2. They're a proud program. You should beat them because you got better talent, better players, and you're at home. Vanderbilt's getting better. Vanderbilt, I think, decided they just weren't going to run the ball anymore a couple weeks ago. but, you know, Carolina's struggled to stop, you know, some of these teams that try to run it but can't throw it down the field. I mean, I think Kentucky's a very average Kentucky team this year. I don't think this is Mark Stoops' best team. And I think Clemson, obviously, we all watch them, and we all know their struggles. And who knows what they'll be like when they get here in a month. You could – I mean, there's still a lot on the table. Get to a bowl, that's A. Beat your arch rival second straight year, that's C. That's B. Beat Kentucky for a second straight year, that would give you 3 out of 5. You want that. Okay, you want that. You want to reverse that trend against the Wildcats. Beat Vanderbilt yet again, you know, and don't have what I call the catastrophic loss. You know, around here when we've had really bad years, you've had that loss to Citadel or loss to App State at home or, mm-hmm. you know, the loss to Vandy in 07, you know, when that team started its downslide. This program last year showed it could win 4 in a row. Well, this is kind of a similar setup, except they had to go on the road to play Kentucky. You know, you had Charlotte, you had SC State. You feel good about those. Then you have Kentucky and A&M at the end. And you know, it's kind of like Clemson. You know, A&M was a talented but struggling team. They have to come in here and play a high Gamecock team. You know, Kentucky is here instead of there. And I think Jack State and Vandy are much better than Charlotte and SC State last year. But those are still games that could be get-right games. I mean, you know, here's the thing. The season's not over. It looks ugly right now. But, you know, injuries in the schedule are a real thing. Sometimes those are excuses. I'm not so sure that's as excuse much as much as it is reality this season for this team, because the combination of those two teams has given you no time to make up for anything. So I think you just got to flush it. It's a new season. You don't have to leave Columbia. You always have played better at home under Beamer. Nobody that's a world beater is coming in here. Nobody. You don't have, you know, Tennessee coming in, or you don't have any game you should be more than a 3 to 7 point underdog. And so that's the deal. I think everybody needs to just – I know people are pissed off. Everybody needs to flush everything and just say, all right, well, the season starts next Saturday. And just everybody get behind it and let the chips fall where they may.
John, where do you think this team is entering November? Confidence standpoint, the whole nine yards. You just, where are they?
I think they're okay from a confidence standpoint. You know, they've lost more than they expected, but they the vast majority of them feel like they're still engaged and playing hard. Like it, I don't see any real sign of give up just yet. You know, maybe that changes if they lose to Jacksonville State this week, but I don't see that right now. You know, Jacksonville State has a seventh year quarterback coming in this weekend. You don't see that very often, but seventh year guy. So he's about as old as you are, Jamie, I think. But you know, it's going to be a little bit more difficult than I think a lot of folks around here are expecting. And but you know what, winning can get a little bit better. Can make things better too on the team. So figure out a way to beat Jacksonville State, figure out a way to beat Vanderbilt, and obviously you're starting to build a little bit of positive momentum at that point.
Yeah, the Jacksonville State team got a nice record at 7-2, 5-1 in the league. I you know, could be wrong, but I'm not going to go out and give them as much credit as a lot of other people are giving them. They've barely beaten some really bad teams this year, like Sam Houston State and UTEP. They're terrible, and they squeak by in games like that. But
they keep playing on, like, Tuesday and Wednesday night.
Yeah, yeah. They're coming in with, like, 13 days rest, man. But they've they did lose. They lost to Coastal, and they lost to the coach at Liberty, Chadwell. They lost to Chadwell's old team and his new team. And
Coastal's those not teams, very good.
Those teams shut them down pretty good. You know, it's just such a different – I mean, it's like playing – it's not necessarily just like playing a triple option team because you don't have to worry about the cut blocking. But that old it's the zone read and all that. Rich Rod basically created it or had a lot to do with it. So it's like playing a Mike Leach air raid team. It's a pure zone read thing. So if you don't stop the quarterback and they get that thing rolling, you could be in trouble. I mean, it's scary from that standpoint. But they're not good on defense, and so I mean, Mario Anderson should be able to run the ball pretty well against them and stuff. I mean, it's just a matter of, you know, I don't know, not giving up big play, not, you know, going out there and playing like you're capable, you know, going out there and playing your best game. Then, you know, it's like Spurrier used to say, we're gonna go play our best game next Saturday, and then the next Saturday, and the next, and you know. And I promise you guys, if they do that, good things will happen, and we'll all be sitting here happier in 4 weeks. I just, you know, you just look at it, and it's like it is a completely different universe, the schedule coming up, than what it has been.
Before we get you out of here, John, a really, really neat moment for Gamecock baseball over the weekend. On Saturday night, as Christian Walker stepped to the plate against his former teammate, Jordan Montgomery, Gumby got the best of him. Sure was neat to see those guys going up. I don't know if you've spoken to either one of them. The series tied at one apiece right now. This is setting up to be, a pretty darn good World Series going six or seven games. But that was neat. That was a really good thing. I wish the networks maybe would have done a little homework as to, you know, who those two guys were and how far back they go. But that's all right. We've done ours around here.
That's right. And I didn't get to watch much of the game on Saturday night. I did get to watch a little bit here and there, but certainly neat for those guys. Hopefully it goes deep into this thing, so we get to see Jordan out there another time. I think we certainly should. You know, Christian hasn't been at his best this postseason, but we know that he can deliver some clutch hits and some big moments. So certainly really happy for those guys that they get to square off on the biggest stage of them all in baseball. And you know, I haven't gotten a chance to speak with them, but I feel quite confident that they're having a blast. And both of them love this place too. Like, you know, Jordan Montgomery comes home. Christian Walker is around here a good bit in the offseason. So, you know, they're still very, very connected with this program.
It's at 8:03 first pitch tonight on Fox. That number rang true on Saturday as well. Pretty neat, 8:03, with those two gentlemen who played in the 8:03 going up against each other. That was really cool. Any updates on Gamecock baseball recruiting wise or fall ball? Who are they playing this fall in their fall schedule?
They're just doing inter squads.
So they didn't schedule anybody.
Yeah, there's some things from a roster standpoint that if you play one of those games against an outside opponent, anybody who plays is automatically on your roster in the spring. And they're just some roster dynamics that they don't really want to have to deal with. So they get they get enough good on good with their own inner squads, and they have elected not to do that. And King's also a little bit more superstitious than I am, but certainly goes in line with the baseball coach. The couple of years that they have done the scrimmages outside of the program, they've had really bad seasons. So they're staying away from that standpoint too.
They will scrimmage at 3:45 on Thursday and again at 3:00 on Friday. Gamecock baseball.
Oh, I appreciate that. I hadn't even seen it yet.
Oh yeah. Got that a little bit ago from Mr. Reichert up there in the SID's office. John, have a wonderful week. Sure hope you get to cover a win next Saturday, because if you don't, we'll cancel our Monday show more than likely.
Yeah, I think that would be the appropriate time, not Labor Day. to cancel the Monday show.
That'd be a disaster. That'd be like, all right, we're taking a break.
Just out of curiosity, John, is it okay if we take Thanksgiving off this year and Christmas? Both of those fall during the work week, you know?
Yeah, I mean, Thanksgiving, you could probably just move around the show a little bit. I mean, Thanksgiving is a meal, right?
It's a meal, right? Yeah, that's right. Somebody get Will on the horn. Let's find out if we're allowed to take that day off or not. All right, bud. Thank you.
Those are like actual real holidays, though. Labor Day is not a real holiday.
Not anymore. Yeah, not anymore. No doubt. It is for us, but not for others. So.
Damn. I had a good Labor Day floating in the river in Georgia on Labor Day. All right. You're right, though, man. You, as always, you are correct.
You're the
Appreciate
man.
Appreciate you guys. Y'all have a good one.
John Whittle John. With the Big Spur. Again, we mentioned last week John took the baseball team up to Spartanburg on Monday for the Trunk or Treat event with the Spartanburg Miracle League and the Barn Dominium Co., who is one of our proud partners here. And John is just a true American. Thanks, John, for what you do for everybody. It's 11:53 on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Pat DiMarco is coming up at the top of the hour. We'll get into some video with him. And a reminder, tomorrow night, the first college football playoff rankings will come out on Halloween night. So once you get done with your trick-or-treating, that'll be fun to fuss and discuss. And, of course, we got plenty to get to today as it pertains to the Gamecocks. We'll look back on the weekend that was in the SEC and look around the rest of the country. I mentioned that Clemson is at 4-4. That's probably helping ease some of the pain for this fan base and the fact that a bad year is not being coincided with a college football playoff type year for the Tigers. As we've seen in the past, that just made things worse, but not so this year. Final couple of minutes here in this, though, I will mention that I don't know if this matters to anybody or not, but it matters to me. Wando this morning officially opened their head coaching position. This has been expected for some time. And there is, quote, from what I'm told, significant interest as they are now turning the page. Thank God for my alma mater getting their, you know, what together, and they're going to go make splash deal. So
we'll keep. There's a couple of guys I've put in touch with you and Flint about that job. So that's that is a job that has a lot of potential still.
Oh yeah. I was on the horn all morning, as a matter of fact, and sending some emails back and forth. So they're going to get it right. They're going to get it right. And one of these days we'll do Inside the Gamecocks live from the press box over there when they do. Because it's been too long. It's ridiculous what's happened with the Warriors. Congratulations to everybody, by the way, who won region championships and things like that. This past Friday night, it was an excellent night for high school football. I hope all of you followed along. I hope all of you followed along on the Chief Sports app as you were able to get your scores and things like that. All right, Phil, it's 11:55. We'll go ahead and turn the page so we can get Pat in on time today at noon.
Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama Columbia, and go Gamecock!
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Cole Joe here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online. NanasPorch.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer. Go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer, just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
It's time for Talkin BAll with Pat DiMarco on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Part of the Chief Sports Network.
Fresh off of a return trip to Buffalo, New York. Welcome back, our friend and the great, former great NFL team captain and all pro, Pat DiMarco. What's up,
man? What's going on, Jamie? How are you, buddy?
Good to see you. I know this is going to be a big week for you two, being recognized at halftime with Coach Spurrier and the rest of that 2010 group that won the East down in the swamp. It's a whole collective group of players from 2010 to 2013. That's going to be a lot of fun, man.
Yeah, I'm excited. I sent out a post. We're trying to spread the word more. I think we have close to 100 guys signed up, but obviously the more the merrier. It's definitely a huge feat and something to really be celebrated for that four-year stretch, most winning time in Carolina history. Hopefully we can get back to those days. But in the meantime, us has-beens, we're gonna take in on that time and really enjoy kind of being back in Willie B. Reflecting on some of those incredible times together and drinking some cold beers and hanging out. I was texting with Garcia. He said, have your boots on, buddy. It's going to be a long weekend. I'm like, oh, yeah, naturally.
Sounds right. Yeah. I'm bringing Hannah and Riley their first game this Saturday. And
awesome. So
that'll be neat for me to be able to – they won't know, but I'll be able to tell them when they get older. You know, yeah.
Well, hopefully Garcia has a shirt on, so they'll down there at halftime. Hopefully he has a shirt on so he doesn't scare the kids away.
Yeah, I was about to say, Jim, put your shirt on. You're scaring all the chicks away. I'm excited. You know, these are all my buddies, you know, and one day we'll be able to say that was their first game. We got plenty of video to get to with you in just a little bit. A lot of plays, some of them are actually in sequence, in which things kind of transpired this past weekend. We'll get there in just a moment. But, you know, I want to go back real quick to 2007 because that team, your freshman year, that team started off 6-1. Y'all were number 6 in the country. And I think that was right after you had just beat Kentucky on a Thursday night, if I remember correctly, Williams-Brice. And things were good. Times were good. Year 3, Steve Spurrier, here they come. They're going, you know, all this and the other. And then y'all got beat by Vanderbilt. And you lost 5 straight to end the year. This team, different scenario here. Different scenario. But it's a team that's struggling. They've lost 4 straight, and they come home. They got 4 straight at home, coincidentally. When you were going through that, especially being a freshman, understanding who the leadership was on that team. I'm not asking you to call people out or anything. That's all I'm saying. Yeah. But understanding the leadership, what is it like in a college locker room at a program in this caliber of a program in the SEC when things week in, week out, they just aren't going well? What is important about getting it back on track? What is it like in that locker room? How fast can it go off the rails? Just give us the whole deal.
Yeah, you know, like, it's a lot easier looking back here as a 34-year-old and, like, being able to reflect on those. Having experienced that in the NFL, like, you're a grown-up at that point. At 27, 28 years old, when you get, you know, adversity hits you in the face and you can sit there, like, you can have grown-up conversations. You can kind of work through these things at, you know, 18 to 22 years old. Are you really mature enough to get through all this? And I mean, there's guidance from coaches and support staff in the building in those instances. But yeah, I remember 6-1. I mean, obviously I was an 18-year-old kid at the time. Thought we were on top of the world, lost to Mandy. No big deal. We'll figure it out next week. And end up losing to Clemson in the last game to miss a bowl game. We were number 6 in the country. We didn't play in a bowl game. How sad is that? But, you know, kind of reflecting on that and kind of where the program is now, I'd say it's a lot of more internal motivation than anything. Like, kind of block out the noise and all the BS on social media and, you know, and everything that's out there, because what matters is what's in the building and the guy that you're fighting for to your left and to your right. At 2-6, it's nowhere near what Shane Beamer and staff and I'm sure the athletic department and everybody had expectations for this year. But if you want to figure it out, you got to bring your lunch pail and get to work. And that's kind of the only thing you can really do is dig it out with the guy to your left and to your right. The reading social media and listening to shows and this and that is not going to help the case because there's a lot of doom and gloom out there. But you know, had the injury bug, right? I mean, how many offensive linemen do we have available?
You ever 6? Seen that before?
I mean, just complete depletion. You got to think from a receiving standpoint, like, obviously Xavier Leggett's not full. Just watching the game last week, he wasn't moving around like he usually does, not having Juice out there, losing Trey Knox. You know, it's kind of lonely right now. But, I mean, Spencer's still playing pretty good football. And anytime your quarterback's playing at a high level, you got a chance to win every single game. And with as bad as it was, it really wasn't that bad on Saturday. Like, yeah, I mean, we lose by 13 or whatever it was. It could have been worse if the Gamecocks didn't give up. They continued to fight. They continued to scrap. They made plays at times, didn't make plays at times. I think we just got to put ourselves in a better situation to succeed at times. I mean, seeing some of the clips you sent me and rewatching it, you know, it's a lot of one-on-one coverage and a lot of not much safety help over the top and some bad leverage without help. But to the coach's defense, like, these are SEC caliber athletes that are now making money, getting their tuition paid for, meals, school, everything, room board. These guys got to go out and make plays too. So it's not all on the coaching staff and putting them in situations. The players have to go out there and execute as well. It's I reflect on my time in the NFL, and it was an older guy. It was Ryan Suckup told me, when I got to Kansas City, he said, "Pat, you're going to learn really quickly. This is a what have you done for me lately business." And it's a production-based business as well. So you have to go out there and make plays. Nobody cares about what you did last week, 2 weeks ago, last season. If you're not doing it right now, there's going to be issues. So, you know, they just got to keep fighting, keep pressing on. And, like, here's a play with Dial right here. Like, I thought Dial played one of his better games, at least from getting guys on the ground standpoint. He had a bunch of tackles, had this big sack, had a few PBUs, was involved heavily. And, I mean, this is a good play. You get a back one-on-one in space, just be an athlete, right? That's exactly what Dial does there.
You know, Pat, early in the game here, the first drive for A&M, there were a lot of different looks that Clayton threw at the A&M offense, and they didn't seem to know what to do with them. A lot of negative yardage there for the Gamecock defense.
Yeah, I mean, I felt like we had a lot of guys, and what we've done is we have kind of like we've made teams one dimensional. Like we've taken like there hasn't been too many teams that have run the ball and thrown the ball and just beat the crap out of us. A lot of it has been one dimensional. We've been able to stop the run in games where, you know, the big thing was, hey, we got to stop the run. Don't let them run the ball against us. But we didn't stop the run. But then they threw the ball over our heads and ran wild on our secondary. And I feel like this was kind of another one of those games. I mean, watching the very first two drives, like watching Max Johnson back there, I was like, man, this guy's not a great SEC quarterback. Like just the ball doesn't come out of his hand hot. Didn't look like he went through his progressions overly fast. I mean, I thought Spencer from a composure standpoint and sitting in the pocket was light years ahead of him, but you know, he was able to get the ball to those guys in space and let number one and number zero, they kind of ran wild in the secondary with the ball in their hands. Like this is a play right here with Spalding in coverage where he has outside leverage and there's no wrap player inside. There's nobody to help him. He has outside leverage, funneling him inside, and he's in a great place, like makes a play on the ball, but there's just nobody else inside. You'd love for Nick. Nick was probably thinking pick there instead of going back and playing the ball. But it's just another instance where you got bad leverage and quarterback made a decent throw, and it's just bad timing.
That's happened a lot this year. We've got more plays like that coming up here, Pat, where the middle of the field has just been flat out wide open, specifically on third and long, fourth down. You've seen a lot of that.
Yeah, I mean, there was a play later that was going to show up, but we had like – I mean, it was. I think there was two of them where essentially we're in cover zero or quarters where everybody's accounted for, but we have seven guys either rushing or within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have guys dropping in those whole spots to cover digs and daggers, all that stuff that in the 12 to 15 to 20 yard range, if you don't have backers in that space with hands up, the quarterback has to throw a high ball or rip it in an open seam. Like it's kind of letting these guys run wild. I mean, I will say, like we got pressure on the quarterback. I think we had two or three sacks. You know, we were able to get in his face and affect him early. This is Brian Thomas, who I freaking love that kid from the day he got on campus. Just played with such a high motor, undersized kid, but just had kind of that dog in him. You know, the last one, Tunka Hemingway, got some vertical pressure inside. Forced it to Tyreek, and they kind of vice tackled him to good sack there. But I mean, this is one of them right here. We add blitz all the time. So basically, if you drop in coverage or you're banjo on the back and the back stays in, that backer kind of triggers and adds. It's basically like an add blitz. But here, I mean, Stone pops out next. Stone actually does a good job of reading his eyes. He's just two steps too slow. And that seemed to show up a lot on tape with a lot of our backers. They were just, you know, a step or two slow and just not able to play in space and get the guy on the ground. Like, man, you give up another 15 yards there because Stone can't kind of balance and make that play.
This is, I think A&M punches it in here to go up 14-7.
And, yeah, that was. I think they had a rushing touchdown on that one right there.
Yeah, wide open too. They came right through the hole there. And the thing that's crazy about this, Pat, is you look at the clock here. It's 3:36.
Like everybody's like is it zero with a whole player, or is it quarters with just man technique? It's just a lonely feeling. Like, unless you're Josh Norman, or unless you're Asante Samuel, unless you're one of those corners that like feeds off of being in man coverage, and I'm like, I'm gonna kick your tail, play in and play out. Like when I was playing in when I was in Atlanta, and Josh Norman and the Panthers were in their heyday, that defense was freaking stellar. But we'd break the huddle, and Josh Norman was standing at the football, like he was playing nose guard, and where Julio went. He's not backing up 1 yard from the line of scrimmage. He is following him the entire way and sitting right in front of him. Like, I don't think we have good enough corners to ask them to be man coverage all the time, locked down. Like, we don't have Cam Smith. We don't have Darius Rush. Like, those guys did that last year for us. That's why we were able to make plays. We don't have that this year. You can't have the same recipe with different players. Like, You know, you have to adjust to your team, and you have to adapt to your team, play to your strengths. Like I thought Dow did play well. OD played well earlier in the year. I didn't really see him too much in this game. But you just have to put your guys in positions to win, and I don't think we've done well with that on defense this year. I see JC kind of shaking his head a little bit.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm Pat, I'm right there with you, buddy.
Yeah.
So, I mean – And I know it's hard. Like, a game plan's hard. You like, I would imagine that we probably thought A&M was going to try to run it all over us. And sure enough, we kind of bobbled them down. They weren't that efficient running the ball. I didn't think they had just over 100 yards. But, like, they had 40 carries for 105 yards. They averaged 2.6 yards per carry. So, like, we made them one-dimensional. But problem is, in the past game, they had God knows how many explosive 15, 20-yard pass plays.
Well, that,
a lot of them were in third and long situations. Plus, they were 4-4 on fourth down, which sucks.
That's Pat. Do you know what the fourth down numbers are this year on defense?
I would imagine it's probably north of 75% giving up.
You're on it. 15 of 19.
Yeah,
I've never seen that before. That's not that's the worst I've ever seen. Actually, it's terrible. I'm not trying to sound like a total jerk, but that is. That can't happen. And it's not like those are all fourth and one, just quarterback sneak, shove it over the top. Let's gain a couple inches and move on. We've seen it fourth and 12, fourth and 15, fourth and 10, fourth and 9.
Yeah. I mean, but the crazy thing is Beamer puts them in those high pressure situations in practice all the time. They do sudden change. They do 2 minute, they do 2 point, like kind of competitive pieces. Like, they do super high competitive, like simulations throughout practice. So, like, it shouldn't be, you know, I would say if you see fourth and seven once and you're like, you know, you get all tightened up and you kind of freeze up in the play, but like Beamer puts them through it. So, I mean, it's either the play calling or execution on the player standpoint. I think you could probably reflect on both of those. And, you know, like 2-6, it's unacceptable. We can't sit there and sugarcoat it much. Like, I think every Gamecock fan's pretty pissed off, especially in the new age of college football where, you know, donors are not donating just to the Gamecock Club. They're donating to the players now, paying the players now. So, like, some of these players got to make their due and make your money. And that was a thing in the NFL is if it was a production-based business. If you didn't play, at least at the NFL, you'd be cut. Or if you didn't get cut, they'd have six guys working out at your position right in front of you on Tuesday or Wednesday after practice to kind of give you a little a nip in the butt and be like, hey, buddy, if you ain't going to do it, all six of these guys would love your paycheck. So I know it's the honest truth, and I mean, maybe a little too honest and direct, but I mean, if we're going to treat them like pros and pay them like pros, they need to be pros. And, you know, we've got to be better. I mean, this week we got Jacksonville State. And shit, we better play with some pride. Cause I know all my buddies from the 10 to 13 years, like if Carolina does not show a good outing this week and play like we should play and play with the energy and the grittiness and the toughness that we played with back in those days, there's going to be a lot of chatter.
Yeah. Well, you got that right. And they'll all be standing there. It won't be, it won't be chat room and message board and Twitter chatter. It'll be, hey, you know, we came in here and elevated this program, and what's going on here?
That's good. I mean, it's not that it's unacceptable, because they are playing hard. And like everybody, we all need grace and patience, right? But I mean, losing four in a row, especially games that you've been in, and it's not like you're playing Alabama, Georgia. Shit, we played Georgia tight. We played Georgia tighter than we played, I think, three of these last four losses.
Whipped Georgia in the first half of that game. Whipped them.
Yeah. But also look at it. It's a big difference in having your stud receiver out there. This is a play I know all too well. Goal line.
Love this
play. Goal line flood pass rollout. I mean, I scored God knows how many touchdowns on that play. Uh-huh. Not that many, but a few, like four. but it's
four more than the rest of us, bud.
Yeah. Well,
I love this play.
I'd be sitting there and I'd be yelling like, I'm out. Like, Tunka's got a step on him. That's the fullback's ball all day, every day. But Josh Simon's wide open too. So, but it is cool to see the team get Tunka and
Boogie
guys involved. I mean, those guys are as Gamecock as Gamecock gets. And it's good to see them involved. And I think they're playing better ball too. I mean, you look, other than having sack production, I mean, those guys from stopping the run standpoint have done that this year. DK, great job cutting and getting the hands down. If he doesn't, that defensive ends, I mean, if he doesn't get that number five's hands down, that ball's tipped, potential's pick. So, as Bill Belichick says, do your job. And DK did his job there, and the rest of the guys did as well.
Here's another one.
We get up in the back end. We have seven guys within 3 yards of the line of scrimmage. And you got four receivers running, like, blazing down the middle of the field. And it's just like, it's really hard to hold up. If you got seven at the box, like, you got to get – somebody's got to get home. Like, you can't cover these guys for more than 3 or 4 seconds. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a lot of space. God bless. Is that Keenan Nelson?
I think it was Keenan Nelson. Yeah. And then right here, I think that was two or three tackles between OD and Marcellus. Had a tough time getting them on the ground there on the sideline. And I think that's one of the things, those of us, I'm one of them in that basket that just doesn't know enough about the X's and O's, or trying to figure out why there's so many third down conversions, down and distance wise, is favorable to the defense, but yet all these teams continue to have guys running wide open across the middle of the field, and with ease, they're being able to
convert. I mean, I will say what I've seen from Clayton, like when Clayton, push comes to shove, Clayton wants to pressure. And there's beauty when you get home, but if you don't get home, it's lonely. I don't know. Like, I've never been a defensive coordinator. Actually, no, I lie. I was for 6 and 7 year old flag football, which was like we're straight zone. Like, guard your area. If somebody comes in your area, pull their flag if they throw it to them. But it's like 90% run game, so it's quite easy. I feel like as well as we're doing stopping the run, we got to maybe stop pounding the box so much and let our front seven hold up in the run game and kind of give the safeties and corners a little bit of a break. From a tackling standpoint, yeah, Debo played really well. Tyreek, but you look like our top four tacklers were two defensive linemen and two linebackers last week. So that goes to show you that those guys played in the box well. But when Nicky Miore and DQ Smith, that targeting penalty was brutal. Losing a guy like him stunk.
What'd you think about that? What do you think about the rule in a situation like that there?
It is so hard because it's like, ball carrier ducks his head too to kind of get in a position to protect himself. Head or neck area, like, well, I went to strike him in the chest, but he dropped his head, and now his chest was his head.
Right.
So just different interests. I mean, I get it from player safety. I got my bell rung a bunch of times. Probably have a few more brain cells left up there if I was protected more. But, I mean, I get it, but it's also a physical sport. I mean, these guys know what they signed up for when they signed on the dotted line to play football in the SEC. It's a grown man's game. And you know who I'd like to see play more is Bam Martin Scott. I haven't watched enough tape to say whether he's playing good, bad, or indifferent, but Bam is a really, really athletic linebacker. I mean, they even put him out in like big nickel situations at some points last year in spring ball and stuff, where he's guarding slot receivers, guarding tight ends in space. I mean, I would say if you're struggling in the pass game and that linebacker position probably isn't holding up as well in coverage as you need to, make an adjustment. Like, I think Bam, I mean, unless he's just like, also, we're not sitting there in practice, so we don't know if he's has 12 MAs and he's loafing and all these other. So, I mean, these coaches are doing their job, and obviously, but I think if you want to change things up, I mean, I think Bam would be a really good plug to maybe be your third down Mike linebacker, or an instance for a guy who can run and play in coverage and has good ball skills. I'd like to see him on the field a little bit more.
They did get Jerron Willis on the field this weekend.
He had a half sack or sack on one of those ad blitzes. It was one of the clips we watched.
What is important for linebackers to improve their playing time? What are you looking for in practice?
I mean, trust. Trust is probably the biggest thing. Trust and communication. I mean, a lot of those linebackers are getting the call from the sideline. They're getting everybody in line. They're shifting. They're stemming. The defensive line doesn't have to deal with much of the jet motions and the sweeps and the and this and that. It's a lot of linebackers. So good eye discipline, communication, and just trust. I know Stones is an extremely smart kid, very fast processor. I mean, within a couple weeks, he understood the defense pretty deep last year. So that's a reason why he's out there, is because of those things. But from a mobility standpoint, it's really, covering like what we tried to do when I was in Atlanta and even in Buffalo is, if you can get a linebacker covering a running back one-on-one in space, like, that's your primary. Like, we'd run, we had a three-man concept. It was called Buffalo. It was kind of a now route, a clear through route, and like a pick curl. And then X receiver on the backside would just want to go. Just like, hey, dude, get out of town and put the back on a choice route. The back would just be a free release. And, I mean, Matt Ryan, granted, we had two really good backs in Devontae and Tevin Coleman, but he would sit there and just pop the ball, like, dude, come on, get open. I know you're going to beat this guy eventually. We exploited that matchup I will say, I don't think our linebackers have been great in coverage this year. I mean, Debo's playing at a high level in the box. Like, yeah, he's got to be leading the team in tackles. The guy has at least two TFLs every single game. I mean, he's like a missile shooting through there. But I'd love to see a little more production in the pass game from our linebackers. I mean, if we're gonna add them and have them play in the box, send them. Let them get home. Let them cause some disruption in there.
I'm not asking you to basically tell us that what we're doing is wrong, for lack of better words here. What I am asking is, the main differences in the style of defense you can run. Like, I know that there's some defensive coordinators who, this is what I run. You know, I run a 4-2-5, or I run a 3-4, or I run a 4-3, or whatever that may be. And there's always going to be little, you know, different deals off of that as far as how they like to call the games and so on and so forth. Then there's some coordinators out there who will make some adjustments with their base defense based on personnel. Do you have any thoughts based on the personnel that we have on defense as to, are we maximizing that talent, or not trying to throw Coach White, he's such a good man, under the bus here, Shane, I don't mean it like that. I'm just trying to figure out what we're seeing out there, because you see some guys come in, they do some good things, and then you don't really see them much again, and you see see some guys in bad spots. Are they being put in bad spots? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, Clayton's some teams live and die, even in Buffalo, like right now, they're a 4-2-5 team. Like, even if teams line up in 12 personnel or 21 personnel, Taron Johnson's the nickel, and he's playing Sam linebacker spot. Like, they're going to play what they play, and they've become really good at it. But the problem really hasn't been stopping the run this year. I need to pull up the numbers and see what we're giving up. I would imagine it's probably right around 100, 110 rushing yards a game, which isn't – like, that's not terrible. And I know in the passing game it's been a lot worse. I think we're probably averaging close to 260, 275, maybe north of that game in the pass game. But, you know, I guess the only thing that I would do is I would get Nicky Meniore or DQ Smith involved more in the box. I know those guys were obviously All-Americans playing safety last year, but I want those guys around the ball more. I want them to have more opportunities to make plays. I think they've done a little bit of that with Jalen Kilgore because he's shown that he can play. He's played at a high level. Yeah. Did he play much? I saw him a little bit in this game, but was he out there? Was his snap count? Was he out there most of snaps?
I don't know snap count, JC. I'm not sure if you know it. I know he played out. He played a bunch. I think he had 3 or 4 tackles in the game. And
I don't know. I know he knocked my pass. My answer would be either put Nick at Mike linebacker or Will linebacker or even at nickel. Maybe put two guys that are really good at the point of attack, get them more involved in the box, and then have your safety valves back there. I mean, Jalen's going to get somebody on the ground. I'm sure you can find another safety to get somebody on the ground. I mean, look at the NFL. Like, linebackers now, Fred Warner, 6, is Nicky Meniore, like the exact same person. He might be 7 or 8 pounds heavier than him, but like, he's a 6'3", long, lanky, really athletic, aggressive, physical guy, and he's playing Mike linebacker. And he's doing it at a really, really high level. So I don't know if there's adjustments you can make with that. I mean, you don't want to take Debo Williams off the field because he's at production, but that would be my 2 cents is, like, just get your more elite players around the ball more, and 12 yards, 8 yards deep, and then have, like, I don't care who you are. Like, it'd be really hard for those guys to tackle me running scot-free at him with 10 or 15-yard head start. I mean, they probably would, but maybe not 5 years ago. I mean, it's really hard to get those guys on the ground in space, but you want those guys to be around the ball more.
Pat, final question, and then we'll let you get out of here. It's 12:30. I sure don't want you to be late for lunch. You got Jacksonville State, and you got Vanderbilt. Matter of fact, you could really make the argument that the next 4 weeks, they're all the games are at home, and each week is a step up in competition.
Yep.
Jacksonville State to Vandy to Kentucky to the Tigers. Gamecocks have a chance to win all of them. Yep. You can make the argument that they're definitely better than two of them. Yep. And the other two at the end of the year, you can make the argument they're right there in the same bucket of water, and had those teams maybe played the guys that these guys have played, their record might be very similar. Yeah. To South Carolina's at this point in time, but that's neither here nor there. What is important about this upcoming game against the Jacksonville State Gamecocks, sitting at 2-6? You have no room for error if you want to go bowling. So from a player's standpoint, coming out of the locker room, these guys walking into the ballpark at 10 o'clock on Saturday morning, what is important about this coming Saturday as it pertains to the rest of the season?
More of a pride thing than anything. I mean, you're going in this game, you're like, I mean, these guys in the locker room got to be pissed. They have to be upset. The seniors that came back, guys that had the opportunity to transfer that didn't because they wanted to be here and they wanted to play for an SEC championship, all these things. But, I mean, like, my mentality is we got to go beat these guys by 40. Like, we have to go get this thing back going and trending in the right direction because momentum is a beast. I mean, even you look at Major League Baseball, look at the Phillies and what they did kind of in their playoff run, beating the Braves and all stuff like that. It's getting hot at the right time. So, I mean, I think if we can get headed in the right direction with Jacksonville State with a big win and get some confidence under our belt, And then obviously to do the same thing again against Vandy in Williams-Brice Stadium. Get the fans back behind your back supporting you. Willie B's a tough place to play. And then Kentucky and Clemson, I mean, I think those games are both winnable and coin flips in my opinion. But I think we really got to we gotta get some positive mojo and give the guys a reason to want to go out there and play. I think you really got to kind of start fast and then just don't let up. I mean, this ought to be a game where you'd love to see some of the seniors that haven't played much play in this game. You'd love to clear the bench because you're up so big against these guys and have some of the older guys pad their stats.
I'm not going to let you get out of here without doing this one more time. Carolina seemed to have virtually no running game at the beginning of the year. We can sit here and diagnose everything there is to diagnose about how poor thus far it's been at 2-6. But Mario Anderson, his story is really unique. And when you watch him run, Pat.
He runs with a purpose, man.
It is fun to watch him play football, isn't it?
Yep. He runs with a purpose. And, you know, he's 100% exceeded expectations. And I think he – probably a part of that was is he was a little pissed off because he was the transfer that came in. He probably was expecting to have a real chance to come in and start right away, and he didn't. And he went and obviously beat out DK and overstepped or overcame Juju and those guys, and he's become the featured back. And he – not one guy's bringing him down. He runs with a purpose. He runs angry. He runs a lot like Chris Ivory, who I blocked for when I was in Buffalo, who played in Jacksonville for a long time. Just ran out. We just said, like, Chris, man, why do you headbutt everybody? He's like, they don't want to be headbutted. So I'm like, yeah, don't headbutt me either, buddy.
That's funny. Yeah, he's something. And congratulations to Denny McDaniel and the Stratford Knights for winning the region championship this past Friday night as well. That's Mario's alma mater and his former head coach, one of the great football guys in this state. You talk about football guys, Danny McDaniel was a football guy. Yeah. So is Pat DiMarco. Your trip was good to Buffalo. You made it home. So that's
it was awesome. The Bills won, so Weston was on a high note. And it was a really cool experience. We brought a couple of buddies from Columbia and their boys. So just a big, good, wholesome experience. I think a good good glimpse into the life that I had when I was playing in the NFL for some of the people here in Columbia to experience was pretty cool. I mean, we were in the facility 3 or 4 hours before the game, and we saw all the players, and I was able to give hugs and talk to a lot of the staff, talked to actually Coach McDermott for like – the guy gave me like 15 or 20 minutes and just like wanted to sit there and talk and hang out and check in on life. Just some all-time great, great people up in that Bills organization. It was a great trip. It was like 70 degrees, though. It was abnormally hot.
I was about to say, it could be 70 up there this week. It's like negative 70 up there this week, isn't it? So
some of my buddies were like, what type of weather should we expect? And I was like, probably 55 to 20. Take a guess. And it was 70. And they were like, I mean, I had a little autograph signing, and a lot of the, I just look like an average, normal person. And a couple of people were like, who are you? Like, what do you do? And I'm like, I'm right here. I'm like, where are you from? And I was like, I live in South Carolina now. And they're like, oh, you brought the weather with you.
So who are you again? Why are you here? Oh, that's funny, man. Well, Pat, first of all, hats off to the Bills for getting a win in your honor this past weekend. Hopefully the Gamecocks will fall in line and get four of them this month. Yeah, a little bit chillier up there. 46 today now in Buffalo. That's normal. There we go. Much more normal now in Buffalo, New York. And look forward to trying to catch up with you this weekend. And a bunch of guys, the 10 through 13 teams that will be recognized at halftime of the Gamecocks, for the first time ever in the history of college football, the Gamecocks versus the Gamecocks will be played at noon on Saturday. And I look forward to clapping for you during halftime and all that fun stuff. And
I'll try to make sure Garcia keeps the shirt on.
I was about to say, make sure Steven's got his clothes on before he walks out.
Kurt Spurrier will be like, yeah, DeMarc, make sure you take care. Make sure you take care of Steve.
Yeah. When does Coach Spurrier come to town? Is he getting in on Friday?
I think Thursday night, actually. He, in typical Spurrier fashion, he called me last week. He's like, "Hey, DiMarco, what are you doing with this reunion? Like, what's your job? I see your name on all this stuff." And I was like, "You know, I was working at the university last year, and it was planned to be last year, so I think they just kind of kept my contact information just for kind of name notoriety and just another resource for guys." And I was like, "Why, do you need anything?" He's like, "Nah, I'm just wondering. Just wondering." I was like, "All right, well, let me know if I can help you with anything."
I'll have a banquet beer for you when you yeah, roll in.
We're running a banquet beer, one of the two.
Well, all the best to him and Miss Jerry, too, as they make their way up from the Sunshine State of Florida. Pat, see you in a few days. Great stuff, man.
All right. See you guys. Go Cox.
Thanks, buddy. There you go. Talking ball with Pat DiMarco here on Inside the Gamecocks. The show. Marion says, "Taking my 5-year-old grandson to his first game on Saturday." Marion, I'm taking my 4.5-year-old twins to their first game on Saturday. So really excited to get them in the ballpark and be able to see all the guys that I kind of went to school with, some of them, and knew back from that area. That's going to be a lot of fun, and hopefully Carolina will get their third win of the year. All right, we will step aside quickly. Plenty more to get to, though. We're served by Chicken Cock Whiskey here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Hey, folks, it's JB, and as we all know, it's football season. My favorite place to shop for myself and the family is Gamecock Traditions in Lexington. They have the widest selection of Gamecocks attire, plus all the cool accessories for tailgating, cooking, kids, shoes, hats, and so much more. Most importantly for me, you can order online at GamecockTraditions.com, and it's shipped timely to your door. I've been shopping here for years, and I hope you will too. Order online right now on the Chief Sports app. Go Gamecocks!
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
If you're on Medicare currently or approaching eligibility, it's time to enroll in a Medicare plan that meets your needs. Palmetto Medicare is here to help you through the process. Palmetto Medicare's owner, Brian Spencer, and his team of experts are here to assist you. Learn about the benefits and enroll in the plan that will cover as many of your medical costs as possible. Some of the advantages of Medicare health plans may include variety of plan choices, increased benefits, lower premiums, and more. Give Palmetto Medicare a call to discuss your insurance and help get the exact coverage for your needs today.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style. In seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
South Carolinians, this message is for you, as well as for people in Georgia, Florida, and Tennessee. If you think you may need work done to your roof or a new roof altogether, there's one simple name to remember: Elite Roofing and Restoration. South Carolina native Jeremy Johnson has been helping people in the South make sure they have the very best people checking on and building new roofs for over 25 years. Fully licensed, bonded, and insured, they provide the best service possible. Call or email today, 678-781-1998. That's 678-781-1998, or you can go to EliteRoofingGA.com. Schedule a no-hassle, free inspection today. Wind damage, hail damage, or just wear and tear. Don't settle for second best. Let Jeremy Johnson and Elite Roofing and Restoration take care of it all for you today.
Thank you. All right, final segment, hour two, JC, JB, and Phil here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Palm Casual, we were there a week and a half ago, and you can still go and buy anything that you possibly could imagine for the outdoors. If you've got an outdoor space, then you want to soup it up a little bit, put some nice furniture back there, maybe a fire pit, maybe you need some chairs, maybe you need new something simple like new cushions or something like that, wicker, teak, you name it. It's the outdoor superstore of the world at 350 Holiday Drive up in Somerville. But good news, Aaron Beasley, the owner, owns the one in Mount Pleasant as well. And if you are a little bit closer to the coast, you can head down that way. If you are coming from out of town and you want to give them a call and ask them, you can even make an appointment with them. Call and tell them you're coming down. They'll make sure they're waiting on you. You can get in there. And I know a bunch of you cleaned it out a couple of weekends ago for the annual warehouse clearance event. But that doesn't mean that they don't have unbelievable stuff. The holidays are right around the corner. You might be one of those families that does the big gift collectively. This could be a great one. So make sure you head to palmcasual.com. And certainly appreciate all those who have bought a bunch of furniture in there, because we know that you have, and we really, really appreciate that. We'll get into a lot of the CFP ranking stuff and plenty more Gamecocks. It was look, this was an interesting weekend from the standpoint of Oklahoma going down. We all talked about that last week. Thought there's a chance. They go down to Kansas after the delays and all that stuff. I thought Utah would be better. I thought that I picked them to win the game. Bo Nix and Oregon whipped them, embarrassed them, as a matter of fact, on their own ballpark, 35-6. One we didn't pick last week. I knew I should have put it on the schedule because they have played really, really well this year. Arizona upsets 11th-ranked Oregon State in a game in which Brian Custer could not figure out whether he was calling Oregon or Oregon State. In the game, he kept calling them the Ducks for 3 hours. Nobody could find a way to correct him. I can't figure that out. You had Georgia Tech taking down North Carolina. Every ounce of me wanted to pick that upset on Friday, and I went with the crowd, and I shouldn't have done it. I thought that could happen. There's Georgia Tech. Brent Keyes got him, JC and Phil, at 3-2 in the league, 4-4 in the ACC. They were just awful a couple of years ago, and now they've got another big upset win. You know, Tennessee took care of Kentucky and held on to win 33-27. I thought Cal was going to pull the upset against USC, but they somehow found a way to hold on at 50-49. Cal went for two at the end and didn't get it. James Madison survived Old Dominion. I know that doesn't mean a lot to somebody, but it was a really good football game. So it was a neat weekend. And JC, you hit the nail on the head when we were picking Louisville and Duke. How healthy is Riley and Leonard? Clearly, he was just not healthy. They didn't score a point in the game.
Yeah. One thing that surprised me about Louisville this year, you know, you always affiliate Jeff Brohm with offense. Their defense is pretty salty. I mean, they played a game against NC State on a Friday night that we watched. I watched it earlier this year, and it was 13-10, you know, and Louisville's defense answered the call over and over and over. I thought they did well against Notre Dame as well. I don't know what happened at Pitt with them, because they gave up 44 to the Mighty Panthers, who were struggling to stay the least. But that's kind of the nature of the ACC this year. It's kind of back to being, for all the good things we've said about that league this year, it's kind of back to being that, you know, unpredictable mess where the good teams are losing to the not-so-good teams. I mean, the mere fact Miami goes to overtime with Virginia shows me something's wrong down there. I mean, I know they beat Clemson. I know they beat A&M. But, man, you almost got beat again. Like, you almost – so you lost to Georgia Tech. You rally, you beat Clemson, right? You almost lost to Virginia to follow that up. I mean, that's unreal. You know, and I'm sure everybody knows about – Clemson's struggles. Clint asked me what I thought about Dave Dorn's statements about Steve Smith. Man, I kind of liked it. I kind of like old Dave getting a little chippy, you know?
Fiery Dorn, yeah.
I thought that was – there's been a lot of that this year. You remember the days where it used to be – no comment. That ain't happening anymore. You know, Kirby threw a shot at Mullen this weekend from the podium post-game down there at the cocktail party. Dan Mullen for picking the Gators, and then basically said, Yeah, well, you know, Dan used to be my friend, but, you know, he doesn't like recruiting. That was the shot he threw at Dan Mullen. You know, I mean, we've been seeing this all year. I guess it's good. I don't know.
Well, Kirby, to his credit, doesn't earlier when Stoop said what he said about NIL, Kirby said, I'm not going to take the bait. To his credit, he normally does a good job of staying out of that. But if you ever have a chance to listen to a couple of his, and you can't play them on the show because they're full of expletives, his locker room speeches.
Yeah.
That's where he lets a lot of that out. I mean, and it's not, I mean, it'd fire me up if I were a dog. I mean, because he's just like against Florida last year, he's like, don't you say a word to these undisciplined MFers. He's like, they won't talk all that S. You let them. This is our year. You got there. You don't say a word. You just point at the scoreboard. You dominate them, and you beat their ass until they don't want to play anymore. I mean, that's like, oh, hell yeah. I mean, you say that to that bunch. I mean, that bunch of monsters they've got. I mean, that gets them fired up. So I think Kirby handles it the right way. But there, and to your point, though, JB, I think it's because there has never been this amount. First of all, I'll say this before I say that. Coaches have never made this kind of money before. So let's just put that out in the open before we start playing the tiny violin of sadness for them. Okay. But second, though, there's never been the amount of crap college coaches have to deal with right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, because in the back of your mind, you know, you're thinking, I wonder who's, you know, tampering with my players right now. There's 85 guys you have on scholarship, 118 on the roster. You can't monitor that. You know, so in the back of your mind, you're worried about that. I think coaches by nature are very paranoid people, and paranoid people sometimes will lash out, you know, because everybody's against me. So here we go. So I do have some empathy for them this season for being chippy like that, just because, you know, these guys, they've got it coming at them from all angles. It's not just about what happens on Saturdays. And then when something goes wrong on Saturdays, God forbid, you know, everybody wants to fire everybody. I mean, you have Gators wanting to fire Billy Napier again all of a sudden. You know, you have hot seat lists by people who are lucky to know that a football is not round. just making hot seat lists, putting it out on a blog for traffic. You know, some of the guys are not, there's no way they'd get fired. You know, you just have a lot going on. You know, whereas even 5 years ago, you didn't have this much. I mean, it's college coaching has become, you know, quite the mission impossible to a certain extent. But also, like I said, these guys are making generational money. Their grandkids don't have to work, you know, now. So it's hard with the contracts like that to sit there and, you know, have sympathy. But I can empathize with having that as your job. I mean, you know, the burnout rate's going to start to get pretty high with college coaching. And I would say if things don't change, but I don't think things are. I mean, I think it's a rudderless ship right now. You know, the NCAA and everything else. So it's sort of a free for all. And, you know, the old saying is to whom much is given, much is expected. So they're getting their money's worth out of college coaches these days.
The Clemson loss to JC falling 24-17. I mentioned this earlier as it pertains to the Gamecocks, a lot of the, people aren't happy that South Carolina is sitting at 2-6. That's not what I'm trying to say. And at the end of the day, nobody would really care what Clemson's record is if Carolina was the, you know, if you reverse that, if they were sitting at 6-2 or something like that, 7-1, but they're not. And so as unhappy as people are, there is, whether anybody wants to believe this or not, it's true. Everybody has that small piece in them that looks over and says, well, at least that team in the upstate isn't headed for the playoff again this year, you know, so it's not making matters worse. That is always going to be the case around here. Everybody's always going to keep their eye on the other one to see what's happening. There's a great chance still that South Carolina can win that game, much like there's a great chance that Clemson can win that game when they play at the end of the year. With all that said, I find it just incredibly fascinating that the Tigers, you know, outside of the Duke game, every game they've lost has been by 8 points or less, but they are 4-4. There is a, I mean, Notre Dame, Georgia Tech, North Carolina. North Carolina is obviously going through some issues here, but, you know, there's a chance that both Clemson and South Carolina, neither one of them are bowl eligible when they play the game last weekend in November. That's wild. That's 1994, man. Welcome back.
Welcome back. Actually, 98 was – 98's the last time they were both – or was it – wait a minute. Was 02 – was that for a bowl? Like when Clemson came in 02?
Went to the Humanitarian Bowl. When did they go to the Humanitarian Bowl? Was that 01?
That was 01. Carolina had bowl wrapped up. This was something like – 02, I think, was that team that went and got destroyed by Leach and Texas Tech. But it was something like Clemson may have had a couple of FCS teams on the schedule, and you couldn't count them. So if they'd have lost, technically, they would not have been going to a bowl. Mm-hmm. I know in 04, Carolina had bowl eligibility wrapped up. Clemson, I think, was 5-6, or at least needing to win that one. But they both obviously did not go because of the – but, yeah, you have to go back to the Tommy Bowden, Lou Holtz era to have a matchup like this. I'll say this. I think Clemson's got a much tougher path to get wins in the next three. But would it surprise me? I mean, you know, Notre Dame starting tight end is now out for the year. So Mitchell Evans, that's a big loss for their offense. Well,
they're home, too. The Gamecocks are home every game in November. So are the Tigers.
So are the Tigers. The one they played
Sunday on. Yeah.
I think that, you know, Notre Dame I think Clemson defensively is good enough to hang with anybody. The problem is their offense is just so suspect. I think their defense gets worn out. And I'll say this, talking to my Clemson people, I'm not telling anybody anything that one of them hasn't said. The defense is good, but they don't play with that edge that they used to have under Venables. It's still good. They're still talented. You're still going to have a hard time blocking them. Their linebackers are elite. They have elite players on that side of the ball. But there's just not that edge. You know, there's breakdowns that happen at inopportune times and things like that. But it's it wouldn't surprise me if Clemson won the next three. They came in 7-4.
I don't think they will, though. I think they'll win. They'll either win one or two, but I don't think they'll win all three.
I think you're probably looking at 2-1, realistically. I think they'll be 6. Although they'll have a bowl wrapped up. But, you know, because I don't know that. I mean, that offense has been waiting to break out all year. North Carolina's probably a good recipe for it. I don't know that Georgia Tech has the wherewithal to hang in with them defensively at all. Because that's two bad defensive teams. Now, Notre Dame will probably be like a slobber fest, like a slobber knocker. Like it'll be pound the ball, play defense, that type of ball game on Saturday. But, you know, that's what happens with Dabo. Once you think you got him and you think he's down, he pulls a rabbit out of his hat. That's the way Clemson normally rolls, you know, even going back to the Bowden era. But, you know, Carolina's got to worry about Clemson when the time comes. I think regardless of what happens to them the next 3 weeks, if Carolina wins the next three, I definitely think they match up well. I definitely think that's a different Gamecock team that you're playing, one with a lot of confidence, having won three in a row. You know, I'm not trying to put the cart ahead of the horse at all. We'll talk more about that when we get there, if we get there. I think the focus has to be on the other Gamecocks this week. And then it's got to be intense focus on Vandy, intense on Kentucky. And then if you make it to Clemson and you still got a shot at getting to 500 and get to a bowl, great. I think it's all of a sudden a raucous atmosphere at Williams-Brice, and you put everything into the game and shoot your shot and let the chips fall where they may. But, you know, the season's not over, folks. I mean, it's depressing. It's sad. I'm sitting here, you know, I was probably a little bit more light in my game thoughts today on Big Spur than how I actually feel. I mean, it's disgusting to be at 2-6 right now, but it is what it is. And, you know, as does happen around here, sometimes we can all let it snowball. We can all let it spiral out of control. You can have another embarrassing loss like to App State or Furman back in the 80s or Pacific or you know, name your Citadel twice, name those teams that have come in here and beat Carolina and made a bad year awful. Or you can rally, get behind the team, understand that injuries and schedule have played a big part in this 2-6 start. Understand this schedule is unprecedented. I can't believe we're going to November. Carolina's had 2 SEC home games, 3 home games, period. 3 home games, period, in 2 months. Yeah. Come on, man. And we know Beamer's teams play better at home. Now, the Florida loss was bad. I agree. But the rest of them,
yeah,
you know, I mean, hey, they're not shockers. You know what I'm saying? So just don't let the shockers happen. I mean, like I said, if these 4 games were at the start of the season, let's even take Clemson out of it. Say Vandy and Kentucky and Jack State. That was your 3 straight openers. Carolina probably start 3-0.
Yeah, well, that's what I was saying earlier. You know, if this was usually that's what happens in September. You get a bunch of games that get you going and get you feeling good, and then you try to figure it out from there. It's been quite the opposite this year for South Carolina. One quick note on that Clemson Notre Dame game coming up this weekend it's time to step aside for a break. The Irish have announced that Mitchell Evans, that's their team's leading receiver at tight end, he's out the rest of the year, torn ACL. So that's a big loss for Notre Dame. All right, more on the Gamecocks and Gamecocks, more on the rest of the college football landscape. And we'll continue to take your questions, comments, and concerns out of the Nana Sports chat box. It's Halloween. You're on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Electric Bikes of Charleston offers the most fun you'll ever have on 2 wheels. Magnum, Velotric, Aventon Bikes, and more. And they sell to consumers all across the state and offer outstanding warranties and service after the sale. 5 levels of pedal assist plus a throttle help you handle the southern heat better, but still get great exercise. Bikes are available all ages and sizes. ElectricBikesCharleston.com or stop into their store in Mount Pleasant. Electric Bikes of Charleston, powering Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Golfers and wannabe golfers, former Gamecock golfer Meredith Taylor is now a full-time golf instructor in the Midlands of South Carolina. In-person golf lessons are held at the Country Club of Lexington. Half hour, hour, on course 9 or 18 holes. And if you're outside of South Carolina, Meredith conducts virtual lessons. Just send in your golf swing for analysis. Gift cards are available for in-person 1-hour lessons. Connect on Twitter at Mayor Taylor and find her online at McKellarEnterprises.org. Her email is on the website. Schedule your next lesson today with Meredith Taylor, former Gamecock golfer.
Not today, sweetie.
One heart's breaking while another one is mending. It's all in the ebb and flow. If I had to, I could go it alone. But because you've become my home. These windows could shut into the ground. These walls could fall right down.
You don't have to tell Mom, right?
Because you've become my home.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
All right, it's a shade past one, final hour, final week, kind of the month of October, because this week also starts the month of November. Inside the Gamecocks, the show, live always from the Signorama Studios. They are the preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics, thanks to Matt Vaughn. He is a great Gamecock, like all of you. If you need anything in the sign world, literally anything, your business, your home, your baseball fields, the rec department, whatever it is, signs. Even if you think, they probably don't do that, I'll bet you they do. They do literally everything. Signorama.com, home in West Columbia. 12 o'clock kick announced by the league for the Gamecocks and the Vanderbilt Commodores. I was going to say Commodores. Do you remember the old days when they used to have Leonard's Losers on? That's what they called them, the Vanderbilt Commodores on Leonard's Losers. So it's a noon kick on the SEC Network at Williams-Brice, not this coming Saturday, but the following, of course. Also at noon on ESPN, Bama at Kentucky. And the only other games, there are two other games that are firm, Auburn at Arkansas at 4 on the SEC Network, and at 7:30 Saturday night, November the 11th, Mississippi State at Texas A&M. On ESPN2, there is a six-day hold on Florida at LSU, Ole Miss at Georgia, and Tennessee at Missouri. I had a feeling they might do that to wait on the outcomes of this upcoming weekend's ball games. So those will all be between the 3:30 CBS, 7 o'clock ESPN, and 7:30 SEC Network slot. Gamecocks and Doors, it'll be back-to-back weekends early at Williams-Brice Stadium, noon kickoff. So there you go.
No surprise.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah,
I love the night games. Love them, absolutely love them. And but I also enjoy being able to kind of get home by, 6 o'clock or so, and be able to kick it into gear, just watch football at night, kind of chill. So I'm all right with that.
It'll be nice. Yeah, I'm taking the family, like a lot of us apparently, on Saturday. So
great day for the family. Yeah, mm-hmm. Great day for them. There's no doubt about that, Phil. And as a matter of fact, with that being a noon kick afterwards, you'll be able to. You got Bedlam at 3:30, Oklahoma and Oklahoma State. You got Missouri and Georgia at 3:30 on CBS that night. You got Washington on the road at Southern Cal. You got LSU at Alabama. I mean, you got some pretty good stuff after this weekend's game wraps up. So JC mentioned earlier, not being able to figure out Miami. I just think it's the Miami culture. I just think I think they get up for the big games and they don't for the other ones. I just think it is what it is. That's just kind of where we are. With that said, though, only a couple of weeks ago, Miami was a team like, could we potentially? I guess you still could, but. Doesn't seem likely at this point. Could we potentially see a Florida State Miami ACC title game? Boy, that would be neat. Yada, yada, yada.
Right now, it's leaning towards Florida State and Louisville. The Cardinals at 4-1, 7-1 in the league. And then anybody know who's sitting right behind Louisville?
Again, Virginia Tech would like a word.
Yeah, Virginia Tech. That's right. After they started 1-3 with losses to Purdue, on the road at Rutgers, and on the road at Marshall, you thought, oh, my God, you know, Brent Pry, he's going to have to sleep in the office. They're not going to let him out of the ballpark. And since then, they've won 3 of 4. Now, nobody they've beaten is any good, okay? Pittsburgh, Wake Forest, and Syracuse, they are a combined 2-11 in the ACC. And they got to go to Louisville this weekend. So that's kind of where I was going with that. You've got Louisville and Virginia Tech for sole possession of second place in the ACC. Florida State, I'm going to be stunned. If anybody wins the league other than Florida State, I'm pretty sure all of the world, the college football world, would be stunned on that. But there's – we thought the ACC was maybe a little bit better earlier in the year. And, you know, guys, kind of here we are again. You know, there's that one top dog, and then they're just kind of everybody else. You're just kind of all there. You know, nobody's really doing anything.
Only two ranked teams, Louisville and Florida State.
Right.
The Cardinals, that's a big one against Virginia Tech. If you're Louisville, you need to stomp on that campfire and put it out, you know, because the Hokies are all of a sudden 3-1 in the league. Virginia Tech wins that one.
Yeah.
Ah, man, then they've kind of got a little bit of an inside track, guys, if you kind of look at their schedule, which is, you know, amazing. I mean, they got good athletes up there. But, man, after Louisville, it's at Boston College, which is never easy. NC State at home and at Virginia. So, yeah. Virginia Tech wins at Louisville Saturday. I think they're the team with the inside track to play FSU in Charlotte, which sounds crazy to say. Lord, they got they got it handed to them in the non-conference. So, but that's when the ACC is bad, that's what happens. Bad teams sometimes get hot, play for the conference championship, even without division. So I think we're back to the same old with that. Clemson, I think, is pretty much out of going to Charlotte, but could still, you know, make things problematic. North Carolina's not completely out of it, but, man, they can't lose another one. I mean, I don't know. You know, you got some options there, but Louisville should probably take – I would think they would take care of business, right? And I mean, with the exception of that Pitt game where I don't know what happened. they've been really solid all year, and a big win over Duke, obviously. So we'll see kind of what happens there. But, you know, certainly things have changed in Blacksburg, at least short term, and they're going to town to try to get a big one. And if they do, you know, like I said, Boston College, Virginia, NC State, it's very manageable for the Hokies.
Yeah, I think Louisville dodged the bullet. This is not on the CW, and it's on the ACC network, so they should be okay.
The Tigers run, it seems over. You know, it seems that way. I know they won the ACC. We're 1 year removed. They won the title game last year, right? Mm-hmm. And they've won eight. They've played in, what, nine? So they've won since 2005. They've played in nine ACC championship games, and they've won eight of them. They're 8-1, which is remarkable. But this would be the second. While they won the league last year, this would be the second year, because they didn't make the game in 21. So this would be the second time in 3 years they didn't even make the championship game. And it just – I don't know, man. I watching that game this weekend, and this is a Carolina show. It's not a Clemson show, but it's our show. Dabo looks just – and they all look tired when you're losing. You know, everybody looks tired when you're losing. But he does. And you listen to him talk. I mean, he's – I don't know. There's something that's – he's frustrated. I get that. I know he's frustrated. You can tell he's frustrated. But it just looks – you know, like he's, I don't know. You know what I'm saying? Something's off. We see this look from time to time with coaches, and it doesn't end well. It just looks off.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you can, closer people are talking about a hard reset, you know, in other words, Dabo needs to clean house and fire coaches and get in the portal and kind of bring Clemson to the modern, you know, era of college football. I know their boosters are excited about getting an NIL thing together and using it like other schools, right? I hope if you're South Carolina that the lack of NIL, embracing NIL, whatever's happened, you know, this year, you know, maybe being slow on some coaching changes, maybe not, who knows, didn't cost you a chance. And then they make the changes necessary. They bounce right back up. Historically, that's what's happened around here. Historically. But this one feels a little different, though, because I'm not so sure that Dabo is going to embrace everything. And I'm not so sure coaches that have had his type of success want to or feel the need to.
I agree with you.
I think I've seen one coach that's great.
What does he have to prove?
Nothing. Yeah, I've seen one coach that's great that said that was given the time to kind of reinvent the wheel, sort of not necessarily midstream, but up the stream a bit, and that's Joe Paterno at Penn State. But they went through some, like, they didn't have years like Clemson's having. They went through, like, your 3-8, 2-9. They were rock bottom. And then he decided, hey, I got to make some changes. He made them, and they were right back up there. And pretty good, really, even towards the end of his career at Penn State. So that's few and far between, you know, as far as things like that that happen. Most of the time, it's situations that end up kind of like Mack Brown at Texas where – Okay. I'll do this. I'll do this. And it just, no matter what they do, it doesn't come together. I mean, Clemson went out and hired who everybody considered to be the greatest available offensive coordinator in the country. Mm-hmm. And you still see the same issues. Now, is it talent? Is it coaching? Is it the quarterback? I don't know. I just know that, you know, there was one change that I think he kind of, you know, they were like, hey, you need to make this. You need to go get this. You need to improve. And so if you're him and you've already kind of taken like the bait that everybody says you should take, and then this is what you got, 4-4 and what, four ACC losses right now? Are you really going to go listen again and say, well, yeah, that's what I got to do? Because they didn't build that program by doing what the mainstream does. They built that program by saying, we're Clemson. We're going to do it the Clemson way. This is the Clemson way, and it won national championships for them. Yeah. So it is a tricky, tricky situation up there, I think, in terms of the future, the past, all that good stuff. It's not coming at a very good time with everything that's going on in college football either. But I'm not so sure. Look, and if they do it, more power to them, great. Mm-hmm. If Dabo is sitting there with new coaches next year, and he's right, these are the pieces to the next national championship, great, super. But it just historically, I've just never seen it where a coach with that much success hits a rut, blows it all up, changes his philosophy in a lot of key core areas, and then restarts. Like I said, I saw it with Joe Paterno at Penn State, but I think he was at Penn State like 26 years before. He made those changes. So they say leopards don't change their spots easily. And so that would be my question about just neutrally looking at Clemson right now.
That's interesting. You think that the Garrett Riley experiment being a failure up to this point, and if it holds, you know, that offense just doesn't move the ball on anybody, could be proof of concept of Dabo's way being the right way? And not, you know, an inferior quarterback play or, you know, just, well, a defense not having that nastiness to it like it used to. That's interesting.
Well, Streeter had a better year than this guy.
I know. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's like, yeah.
Part of it may be I was correcting this. Klubnik.
Yeah.
Sorry.
You're good.
I've had a bad year with name pronunciations. But Cade, just for lack of a better, so I get it right. I don't think he's that good. I'll say it. There was an article on 24/7 Sports where basically blame Dabo for it. I don't know, and I don't know that it's Dabo's fault. I don't think the kid's that good. I never thought he was a five star. I thought he was, you know, kind of your normal Texas quarterback. I don't know what he did at what camp to impress anybody, but it's not like do you guys look at his arm and go, my God, that kid's got so much talent. I don't. He doesn't run it all that great. I mean, I'm sorry. I don't know. I mean, maybe it's just that he doesn't have receivers. I know they struggle. They're struggling at receiver, but I don't know.
I don't. I agree. I said that Saturday watching the game. I don't think he's that good. I think that he's got some incredible talent. There's a reason why everybody in the country recruited him. Mm-hmm. I think that you mentioned a harder reset. I think this kid needs a harder reset. I think he's in his second system in 2 years. There is a lot of pressure that comes with being the quarterback at Clemson. DJ Uiagalelei proved just that. A guy who's actually played very well out at Oregon State, a lot better than he played at Clemson. But, you know, it sure was difficult for him to step into the shoes of Trevor Lawrence, who had no issue stepping into the shoes of Deshaun Watson. And just, you know, those guys were elite guys. Since then, each quarterback that has run out onto that field has been expected to be at that level. I mean, you're talking about, what are you talking about, 6 years of elite quarterback play? I mean, look at this guys, Deshaun Watson, Trevor Lawrence. So since that you run out there, there's a lot of pressure on you. And I think there's just a magic potion that is missing. And then you got Notre Dame coming in. This is the first time Notre Dame's been here to Clemson since the Bring Your Own Guts game in 2015. Guts. And they're coming in with a quarterback who has lit up the midnight sky the last couple of years against the Tigers defense. He's thrown for 749 yards and 7 touchdowns in the last 2 years against the Clemson defense. You know, so you know damn well what Notre Dame's going to come in here and try to do, and they got estimated running back. So they're reeling. They're reeling. And I don't think it's been so long since they have been through anything like this up there, guys, and I don't think they know what the answer is. And that's just, you know, for Gamecock fans, that's something to celebrate. I'm with you. I'm right in line with you. For, you know, for that Tigers football program, it's a little scary.
I'm not sure it's as simple as, hey, it's like 2010 all over again. That 2010 team sort of had some guys that, I mean, they Spiller left the year before in 2009. They didn't really replace him. Jamie Harper is okay. The next year, Andre Ellington got going, and Taj Boy got going, and Sammy Watkins was a freshman, and they won the ACC that year. But, I'm not so sure it's that easy. I think there's, you know, and we're in a different era. I mean, we're in an era where everybody else, okay, we got a bunch of guys that didn't pan out. We're going to run them off and go to the portal and get six guys, you know. Yeah. And this, I think from just a Clemson standpoint, you were still 2 years ago, a year ago, you're still one of the hot programs in college football. You know, you watched them last year, and yeah, they lost to Carolina and didn't make the playoff, but they were 1 point away from making the playoff, right? Essentially, they won the ACC. The bowl game was the bowl game, but whatever. And they were still in a position as a program to attract just about anybody they wanted to go get, and they just didn't. And even when Alabama and Georgia are filling needs in the portal, I mean, I think that's a sign. You can't just, you know, especially with the way Clemson recruits, because Clemson also, people mistaken this. Yeah, they're signing a bunch of five stars, four star guys, but the second group in their classes is usually either made up of guys that you go, holy hell, how'd they evaluate this guy, like Tyler Brown, mostly from in-state, or it's guys that never play. You know, they've been fortunate, too, injury bug-wise, up there for a long, long time. You know, they haven't had the injury South Carolina has at all through the years. But their depth isn't Georgia-level depth or Bama-level depth or Ohio State-level depth either. And so when you don't have – when you're missing that depth and then you miss on maybe one or two receivers that aren't as good as you thought, then your receiving core suddenly needs help. You know, guys do get, and guys have gotten banged up, you know, the kid from Myrtle Beach, you know. So anyway, don't want to talk too much about Clemson, but it's relevant. It's relevant.
It is very relevant. I mean, this is the state of South Carolina, and everybody spends 365 days a year worrying about them anyways. It's absolutely relevant. I mean, these guys are struggling. If you're South Carolina and they haven't had a chance to do it, they haven't recruiting, as JC has noted 1,000 times here. They're whipping the Tigers in in-state recruiting. But this is kind of a moment here. You know, you beat them on their own field last year, and you got them coming to your ballpark in 4 weeks. And, you know, I mean, we're all anxious to see what type of team they walk in here with. Have they lost another couple of games before they get here? Have they gotten hot? I mean, this is a moment for Gamecock football. All everybody did was bitch and moan every freaking year about losing to this program over and over and over. Pardon my French, but that's all everybody did was complain, complain, complain. Now they suck as per their standards. They suck per their standards. And Carolina has an opportunity to take advantage of it. And all of a sudden, people don't want us to talk about it. Go find another show. I don't care. This matters. You know, this matters right now for South Carolina in the position that they're in and the position that team in the upstate is in, period.
I mean, I'm with you. And I think it all matters. I think Jacksonville State, what they've done to this state matters. I think that Vanderbilt's got Auburn this weekend, you know. That's kind of a tricky game for Auburn going up there. Auburn struggles sometimes on offense. Vandy does have enough offense, I think, to be in that game. Vandy's gotten better on offense, but you know, you want to talk about terrible. I mean, they've had some moments. They, you know, Georgia kind of let their foot off their throat. They don't run the ball. They don't even try to run the ball mostly. So you can't let them, you know, and their defense just gives up yards and points like it's going out of style. But I think it's relevant what they do. You know, everybody talks about Kentucky like they're, you know, the Alabama Crimson Tide from the 70s. They got a game this – all right, so they got – their next two are interesting. At Mississippi State, whose back is against the wall, but it's on the road. It's down there. Kentucky's lost three straight, including again to Tennessee, yeah. Right? Then Alabama comes to Kroger Field for a noon kickoff November 11th. Win or lose, that place – I mean, I think it's been like 15 years since Alabama's been up there, if I'm not mistaken. That playing Alabama can take your soul out. So then they're coming to Williams-Rice the next week, maybe having lost five in a row or at least four out of five. You know, I mean, and then you got Clemson, and they've got three difficult games, but they're all at home. So we'll see. I mean, you know, South Carolina, we always look at it through a bubble, right? But you have to understand there's other – you know, other teams go through adversity and many times turn it around. And a lot of it is a function of schedule and who they're playing. And there's not been a team in the country that's played the schedule South Carolina has. There absolutely has been one game you could maybe say was a break. And that was Furman. And Furman is one of the best teams in FCS and came to town and played a good ball game. So, I mean, let's be a little more – I mean, there's one thing being realistic and wallowing in the doom and gloom, but there's another thing being realistic and saying, okay, this just isn't like other years where there were three or four cupcakes in September and, you know, you can rest on that for the rest of the season and get to a bowl. This year, the tough part of the schedule was at the beginning.
Yeah.
You know, everything from lack of home games to a quality of opponent, you know, the only game I look at and go – man, it should have had that is Florida. You know, just being honest, every other team South Carolina's lost to is better. You know, and you can say North Carolina's not better now, but if they came to Columbia or they played in Charlotte next week, I think Carolina's got a pretty good shot to beat them. but at the time, you know, North Carolina was just better as an opener. So I think that the opportunity has to be you know, embraced, and you got to look at it like that, because there's nothing to be done about the first eight games. You can't change it. Can't change it. And I don't think that it's wise to just jump to, all right, coaching changes and portal and new roster, because there's still so much left on the table. It's important for this university to beat Clemson. It's important for South Carolina to beat Kentucky, considering the recent history there. It's important for South Carolina not to lose to teams like Jacksonville State and Vanderbilt. All four of these games have meaning when you're talking about the big picture. So it's not time to wave the white flag yet. You know, there'll probably be changes made after this year. Don't get me wrong, but you have to, you know, you have to kind of look at it right now, more like an opportunity than woe is me where we are, where we're at. Because when that starts to set in, and hopefully it doesn't set it inside the building, that's when you lose to Jacksonville State at home. That's when that happens, is when teams just like, I don't care anymore. It's over. You know, and it's not. It's hanging on by a thread,
yep.
But it's not.
Gamecocks' first eight opponents are a combined 45-13. Their final four, 18-16, per JC's notes a minute ago of what is coming up on the schedule. It is 1:28 p.m. here, the day before Halloween, or Old Hallows Eve, as they called it. I don't know if they still do or not. Gamecock traditions in Columbia can get you looking good for the Jacksonville State. Like, you bring it. How many people were in the chat box today saying they're bringing their kids for the first time? Why don't you take them? Why don't you run them by there on Friday if you're going to be in town? Run them by Gamecock traditions, maybe after the game Saturday, and go get them a special shirt or something for their first game. Maybe it's a football you want to take out there and see if you can get some players to sign it or something like that. Gamecock Traditions is the one-stop shop for everything when it comes to Carolina athletics. And, of course, if you aren't going to be at the game and you can't go to Lexington because you don't live in the area, just order online. They send it. That's what I do. They just send it to the house. We plan on taking our children in there this weekend. I'll let them pick out something special for their first home game, first game in general outside of a spring game. Maybe someone else can make that a tradition as well. GamecockTraditions.com in Lexington. All right, plenty still to get to. Still a half hour left in our program. Tomorrow night, the college football playoff rankings will debut for the first time in 2023. Who's going to be in there? Who's going to be in there? We'll take a look at that more when we return on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And chicken cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
If you're in the upstate of South Carolina and are in need of residential real estate services, Cindy Bass Searfoss of Caldwell Banker Kane is for you. Ask her about the Village at Creekside, all of her listings in my hometown of Spartanburg, South Carolina, right there on Daniel Morgan Avenue, married to a lifelong Gamecock fan. And many of our listeners have already bought homes from her and been 100% satisfied with the detail and care she uses. Cindy Searfoss, 864-414-5271, Caldwell Banker Kane in the upstate for your real estate needs.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barn Door Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy insulation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Door Company. Gamecock owned. Gamecock operated.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama Columbia, and go Gamecocks!
This crowd, the atmosphere that's going to be in that stadium,
ready to explode, just as they do each time their Fighting Gamecocks are introduced.
And so this frenzied crowd ready for the kickoff.
And a rave breaks out in Columbia.
And what you're about to see is a spectacle unto itself. Let's enjoy.
It won't be a night kick, but we will certainly be excited to get back. Finally, as JC pointed out, it has been really weird. Get back to Williams-Brice Stadium.
I mean, three home games, dude. I mean, yeah, so far, it's November.
It, I will say this, because I've been to every game. I've been to Charlotte and then every home game. Weather's been great and all, except for the Furman game, the beginning of it, when we got out there early that day and the pouring rain and the wind, that sucked. But it hadn't been hot, and it's not going to be hot this coming weekend. So we dodged that bullet this year in Columbia. Yeah. Hats off to the college football gods for making sure nobody died of heat exhaustion at Williams.
Sure. Yeah. They just gave them a 2-6 record.
Yeah, but you know, I'd much rather be 2-6 than hot.
And 80 degrees in Columbia, Missouri, which is very curious considering certain things that I won't bring up right now. But anyway.
That's right. All right, tomorrow night on Halloween, which, by the way, today, Phil, in your honor, is National Candy Corn Day, so have at it, pal.
All right.
Go there for it. You just litter yourself with candy corn, do whatever you want to do, and
bathe in the candy corn.
Well, that bowl was a little tighter than I had expected it to be.
Sleep in it. Yeah, candy cane. Who won the bowl?
I think it was
the haters?
I think the haters won the poll, but it was by a thin margin.
Way to go, boys. Way to go, girls. All of you candy corn haters, step into my office. I'm with you. I agree with you.
Yeah, I'm with the great Mike Leach, rest his soul, hated candy corn. But he liked other things. So.
Nah, screw it. That place, they suck. All right. Tomorrow night, Georgia, Michigan, Ohio State, Florida State. Those are the top four via the AP. Washington is right behind them, also at 8-0. It's between those five teams as to who's going to be in the top four. I don't know that it's going to be any different from the way the AP looks right now, guys. I think it's going to look exactly like that. Maybe Ohio State at 2. Because they have a better resume than Michigan. But I don't know that it looks any different than that.
Washington's margin of victory is what's going to get them, because they've struggled the last 2 weeks against not-so-good football teams, probably the bottom two teams in the Pac-12. That's going to get them when you compare to Michigan. But when you compare who they've played to Michigan, there's no comparison. They've played a much tougher – Michigan has not played anyone good. Of course, things like Nebraska – by the way, the Huskers are on a 3-game win streak and could win the Big Ten West, just to tell everybody. I'm not going to talk about the offensive coordinator out there, though. which I would be happy for their fans, because they have such great fans. But things like that kind of help Michigan's cause. I'm with you. It's probably, Florida State. What Florida State's got two good wins. I mean, the Clemson win still counts because it's at Clemson as a good win. And then beating LSU by 21 at the opener is going to go a long way for FSU. So the order may be a little different. But I think Georgia should be number one just because Georgia's schedule hasn't been as weak as maybe people have thought. Ohio State, though, who has two better wins than those guys, at Notre Dame and Penn State at home? I don't know.
That's why I was saying there's, maybe Ohio State slips into two. just because of the resume. I think it depends on the committee, right? I mean, what are they valuing right now?
And it changes.
I mean, is it just the results versus whom you played? I mean, it's not just that. I get it. But do they value that more than what their own eyes are telling them about the football team? I mean, keep in mind, Ohio State and Michigan are play at the end of the year. So somebody's gonna lose. Mm-hmm. I think I'm not really as curious about who's in the top four. I am much more curious about who the next six are. Because Oklahoma crushed themselves by getting beat by Kansas on Saturday. They're not out of it, but they crushed themselves. And it's interesting, Texas beat Oklahoma. I mean, Oklahoma beat Texas earlier in the year. And now Oklahoma's got a loss on the road at Kansas. But what is the likelihood? Texas right now is ranked number 7. I think Oklahoma comes in at 10. So what is the likelihood that Oklahoma, who beat Texas, is ranked below the Longhorns in the college football playoff rankings tomorrow?
Yeah, probably. Go ahead, Phil.
I would say they probably will put them behind Texas and then in a sort of a prove it mode. And Kansas may have just ruined the Big 12's chances of getting in the playoff.
especially.
I don't know. I'm not saying you're wrong, but they may have, but I don't know.
Here's the thing. What if Oklahoma and now the standings are weird. It's like Iowa State is technically in the hunt to go to the championship game. They're 4-1 in the league.
With that win.
With that win the other day. And so, man, I don't know. It's one of those things where if you look at a conference that should be out, I think it'd have to be the ACC if Florida State happens to screw up and lose one.
Yeah.
First and foremost, they're on the chopping block first. And then I think the Big 12 would be right after them. That's hard for me to say just because I think one of the great things about the Big 12 is they have parity. But I don't think you should be punishing the Pac-12 teams right now. Oregon by any – if you're counting eyeball tests at all, man – you know, it's Oregon's a great football team. I mean, you don't just – you're not man enough most Saturdays to walk into Rice-Eccles Stadium and blow those jokers out. Not just beat them, they blew them out. Like, they weren't even – they looked like they didn't belong on the same field as Oregon.
Is that the most impressive win by an undefeated team this year?
Well, they're not undefeated.
Because Oregon did take that loss. But is that the most impressive by one of the top tier teams this year?
That's one of them. I think Texas and Alabama would be the other.
Yeah, that was
that I would bring up.
Thinking about.
Are you talking about in general or on the road?
Just in general, but on the road obviously makes it tougher.
Like, what is the most impressive win of the year?
Yeah, what's the most impressive win? Yeah.
Among the teams that are in the mix.
If you're still in it, if you're one loss or less.
Well, I mean, Florida State against LSU they beat them by 3 touchdowns.
Had to be. Yeah. I think LSU's lost to Ole Miss, takes some shine off of it, but mm-hmm. LSU's still a damn good football team.
But when you consider what Utah's defense has been doing to teams up until this point,
What about Ohio State and Notre Dame? I mean, all this is still going to play
itself out. Impressive win for sure.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, like, Ohio State has probably the best resume going into this, you know.
Oregon's win was just so thorough. I mean, you just – like I said.
Yeah, it was complete.
Look at the recent history of the Pac-12, there are not very many teams, Oregon included, that have marched into their – I mean, I joke about the man enough stuff, but they're really not very many teams that have been man enough. Game day's there. Everything else. I mean, you know, Utah at the very least is a physical football team. You have to match their physicality. Oregon did it, then some. I mean, they're playing defense out there. I know they lost a shootout to Washington, and Washington's a really good team, especially on offense. Maybe Washington comes back, and, you know, sometimes when you have a couple of games like they've had, you win them, and then you wake back up, and you're dominant again. But man, oh man, Oregon beating Utah like that, I think that puts them right back in it. And I think you have to respect the strength of the Pac-12 if you're the committee this year. You know, whereas in years past, everybody just wrote it off. It's like, oh, it's a BS league or whatever, man. The play out there is too good. The quarterbacks are too good. The teams are too good. The coaches are too good to just say, oh, well, you know, it's they're not a good league because one team wasn't able to go through undefeated.
So, yeah, fair. All right, let me pose this to you then. With all that said, I think that, look, we're SEC guys. We see through that lens. Not saying that what I'm about to say here is true. I'm not saying it's not true. Michigan could potentially stake a claim for being ranked number one tomorrow night. Okay. Georgia, between those two teams, Michigan and Georgia, they have combined for exactly one ranked win this year, and that the Dogs got it, 51-13 at Kentucky. All right, so not exactly that impressive now based on what we're seeing out of the Wildcats, in my opinion. But when you go look at Michigan, you eyeball it, you eyeball the schedule, and then if you actually go look a little bit, they're very comparable. And Michigan, first of all, hasn't given up over 10 points in any game this year. But look, East Carolina, UNLV, Bowling Green, please. Okay, they beat Rutgers 31-7. Please, right? Well, Rutgers is 6-2 and 3-2 in the league. That's respectable for the Scarlet Knights. Mm-hmm. They went on the road. You just pointed it out a minute ago. Look, Nebraska is 5-3, 3-2. They beat them in Nebraska 45-7. Keep in mind, if Nebraska had won the game, they'd be 6-2, 4-2. Remember, these records are always only dependent on based on the team that you're talking about if they played each other. They went to Minnesota and won 52-10. Minnesota is in first place in the West. All right, they beat Indiana 52-7. Indiana's awful, and they beat Michigan State 49-0. Michigan State is awful. But they did exactly as you say all the time, JC, do what you're supposed to do, and they have done that. So, I mean, like, it is real. Michigan, although they don't have the signature win, Phil, you pointed that out a minute ago, they'll have every opportunity to get it in a couple of weeks on the road at Penn State. And then, of course, they've got Ohio State at the end of the year. But, like, if Michigan has done enough to be the best team in college football where the committee says, we think that you are more impressive than Georgia and you're number one, that buys them a loss because they could lose a close game later in the year and very much not even be close to falling out of the top four.
That's a good point. Yeah, they got two top 10 teams left. Yeah. You know, in the case with Georgia, they're going to have to earn it too. They have three straight top 25 opponents, starting Saturday with Missouri, and then Ole Miss, and then Tennessee. I mean, it's at Georgia Tech. The only thing about that game I can say is it's probably not going to be 90% dog fans this year, maybe 60. At least some jackets will show up because it's at least they at least have an offense and all that stuff.
I don't think that game is just going to be a blowout. I don't think Georgia loses, but
yeah, I mean they're going to have to.
Dude, Brent Key has put a lot of pride back into that Georgia Tech uniform.
They're going to have to be man enough. That's for sure. March into Grant Field. Yeah. Bobby Dodd Stadium. You know, no, I mean seriously, I think Tech can play with them as a team to play. Haynes King, who you know, maybe Jimbo wishes he had King. I mean, there's a reason Jimbo kept trying to put Haynes King out there and he kept struggling. But Haynes King's dealing now. And you know, I don't know. I just it's gonna be interesting. I do think I am bullish though on the Pac-12 as long as nobody drops anything else, you know, that they shouldn't. I am bullish on that league and do think that maybe a one loss Pac-12 does get in this year just because top to bottom, you know, it's one of the most competitive leagues in the country.
So you've got, so you're right. You're right. It is a neat league. I mean, I mentioned earlier, Arizona's 5-3, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I mean, you've got UCLA's got, you know, having a nice year, 3-2, 6-2, Arizona, you know, Washington State started off well and they've kind of fallen on their face since. Stanford, Arizona State, not good. Arizona or California almost beat Southern Cal this past week. But the finish to the year for Washington with the trip to Southern Cal this weekend, and then they've got Utah at home, and then they got to go to Oregon State, who's at 16th in the country. We'll see where they are tomorrow night in the playoff rankings. And then they've got Washington State at the end of the year for the Apple Cup.
Yeah. Yeah. If they get through those, they're in, I think.
Well, they get, I mean, you still got to win the Pac-12. You still got to win the
title. Oh, yeah. Because, I mean, if it's Oregon again and they beat Oregon for a second time, yeah.
Oh, they're in. It's not even close. Yeah. Dude, they're in. But if you go undefeated and you lose the Pac-12 championship and Oregon wins it and those two teams split, what do you do? You know, if that's even a possibility for the fourth spot.
I'm having to go with eyeball test at that point. And if Oregon continues to play dominant football and you're looking at them losing a 3-point game in Seattle semi early in the year, it's a rivalry game. And then they go and play in the Pac-12. I guess the Pac-12 is going to be in Vegas again this year. And they go to Vegas and stomp a mud hole in them. Then I think you have to go with Oregon. I mean, you know, the eyeball test sort of takes over. And the committee does reward – like these wins are not equal, right? The regular – the committee's proven through time, except last year.
Yeah.
When they just put TCU in regardless. They were hell-bent on doing that, I think. Until last year, they've said conference championships matter. And, you know, that was their whole reasoning for leaving – TCU and Baylor out of, you know, the first year they had it and putting in Ohio State. You know, that said, I'm still convinced if that were Texas and Oklahoma tied for the Big 12 title, those two teams would have been in. I still think you fight that a little bit with the committee. But, man, oh, man, I mean, there's a lot of decisions. I mean, the whole Michigan, Ohio State, Penn State thing, I know Penn State lost round one, but what if they beat Michigan and then Michigan beats the Buckeyes and you're sitting there and they've all – you know, it's like that Spider-Man meme where they point, you know, what do you do? I mean, I guess, well, whoever wins that tiebreaker and goes to Indianapolis and should they win, which they'll be overwhelming favorites, I guess they get it by virtue of whatever the tiebreaker is because, you know, or do you put two Big Ten teams in? I mean, this is going to be a very, very fascinating year. And I like it because, you know, I generally like all the teams that are still in there. I mean, I got a lot of respect for most of these teams. I follow them on Saturdays and stuff. I know some of the fans. So it's an interesting type of deal. And you know, I don't know that we've gone into the beginning of November with this many quality teams. I mean, I think we've gone into it with teams who are mathematically alive, you know, math-wise. But this many quality teams, you know, chugging towards the finish line, it's going to be a hell of a finish.
Well, and you have head to heads that will help decide all of this because you have Michigan and Ohio State, potentially you have Washington and Oregon. You could have Texas and Oklahoma, although I Oklahoma going to Oklahoma State this weekend. I'll just go tell you this. I ain't picking Oklahoma. I'm just not. Oklahoma State's better than people think they are, and they got a chance to get into the Big 12 title game as well. They're not ranked, but they're 6-2, and they're barely outside. They're 26. They received the most votes without being in there. So, like, you've got a lot of the head-to-head. And then, hey, there's a team we haven't said a word about in this entire conversation. Where is Alabama going to be tomorrow night? Where's Alabama? Because if Bama beats LSU, look, they can't lose again. If they lose in the regular season, they're out, okay? But the scenario is still there. If they beat the Tigers and then they go to Kentucky, go to Auburn, blue-collar road games, and if they're able to pull those wins, they beat Chattanooga, they finish the year at 11-1, and they beat Georgia. Here you are again with the SEC having two teams and you're going, what do we do? I mean, so you're right. It's a really, really, really unique situation with a lot of head to heads that ultimately will be deciding all this.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting. It was like, okay, so let that scenario play out, right? And Alabama defeats Georgia and Atlanta. Will Georgia have played enough good teams at the end of its schedule to still find a way into a playoff if you don't have four or three other undefeated teams? Because, I mean, I think you still give the SEC championship, the champion, even a one loss.
You're saying if there's they multiple get in. One-loss teams, Phil?
Yeah, let's just say there's – well, okay, so Michigan and Ohio State are going to play, and that's going to sort out the Big Ten undefeateds. And let's just say whoever wins that goes undefeated. So that's one undefeated team. Washington wins out, beats Oregon in a rematch in Las Vegas, two undefeated teams. So now that clears out all your undefeated teams.
Except for Florida State.
Florida State, yeah, okay, so that's the third one. So Florida State's in, and then so Georgia, somebody's going to have to get tripped up somewhere.
Georgia would have to be out.
Yeah. So Georgia would be on the outside looking in if there were three undefeated.
But just like Jimmy, but what – all right, so what if, though, there's not – what if Washington trips up?
Yeah, what if Washington trips up?
Loses to Oregon, and then you got Bama, and you got 2 1-loss SECs plus Oregon – maybe a one-loss Texas is in there too. I mean,
they went out.
Yeah, Alabama. I don't know.
Head against Bama, who just beat Georgia. It's interesting. Like, JC, you just said it. It was like we've never had so many dogs in the fight this late.
Let's say Georgia spanks that hiney for the rest of the year, right? Yeah. Like they beat the crap out of Missouri, Ole Miss, Tennessee, Tech, and then they happen to stub their toe against Bama and lose by a field goal
in a close game.
I don't know how you keep Georgia out with that. Just with the and put other one loss teams in, because you know, you can say what you want about Georgia's schedule. Well, guess what? Turns out it's a little tougher than people thought.
Yeah,
turns out you know they've got 3 top 25 teams right here in a row. You know. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know how you keep them out, and I don't know how you keep the SEC champion out. But at the same time, I could make a case. I mean, so if you're Texas and you went out, and you're sitting there going, "Well, we beat Alabama on their home field by 10 points. Does that not count anymore?" You know. Yeah. So I mean, it's a thing. Teams like Florida State's the team that has to stay undefeated. Like if they lose in Gainesville, like let's say everything goes hunky dory. Undefeated in the ACC, and then they go to Gainesville and play one of those games where that crowd gets into it and Gators this and Gator bait and chomp chomp and they're turning it over, you know, and they lose. Whew, that's it. I don't think they're making it.
That's the equivalent of Carolina over Clemson last year. Boom, you're out.
Yeah. I think that's probably it. So I don't know. I mean, it's there's a lot of fascinating scenarios. Hopefully one day we're talking about the Gamecocks. But, hey, maybe we will be because it's going to 12 next year.
This whole thing is making the perfect case for 12 right now because of all the one-loss teams out there. And even, like, the two-loss teams. I mean, LSU is they don't have a chance at 6-2 because they've got a loss against Florida State. They got a loss against Ole Miss. Although they beat Alabama, Florida, Georgia State, A&M, finish year 10-2, beat Georgia in there, they'd have as – good of wins as anybody out there, but with two losses, I still think they'd be behind. Here's my point though, like with when you get an expanded playoff and you go, golly, the hottest team in the country is LSU, they're 10-2. You don't want to play them right now, but they're going to the Capital One Bowl. They're going to the Sugar Bowl. They're not going to the playoff next year. They'll be in the playoff, you know. So you could have that. You could have that two loss team that nobody wants to play at the end of the season. All of a sudden competing to win a national championship.
Yeah. You'd have some interesting games if you were to shut it down and just use the AP for right now. You'd have Notre Dame at Washington because those are going to be on-site games, right? Yep. Notre Dame at Washington. Yep. Ole Miss at Oregon. Mm-hmm. Oklahoma, Texas 3, I guess you would assume. Yep. And then Penn State down in Tuscaloosa.
Down in Alabama, yeah.
All right, question though. What if Ole Miss wins out?
That's the other side of it. Yeah. If they win out, then they don't have, they're in that weird position where they're not going to the championship, assuming that Alabama also wins out.
Yeah.
And then and they're just a one loss team kind of hanging out. I think they get, no, you're, there's no way you're putting Ole Miss.
Alabama would have to lose twice.
Yeah.
Because if they went out, they have the best win in the country at Georgia.
Listen, if Alabama wins at LSU, all right. So LSU beats Alabama this weekend. All of a sudden, you're in that three way tie. Area, right? I don't know who would win in that situation. If it gets to a vote, Ole Miss has no chance because they're not a blue blood. But if they can win the tiebreaker before the vote, which I don't know, so Bama, that would be Bama's only loss in the league, would be to LSU, and that's in the, so it's all in the division. They all will have beaten each other. So yeah, that's tricky. That's very tricky. But if Ole Miss wins out and does not make it to Atlanta, and they're sitting there with one loss, and that's to Alabama, and Alabama makes it, and other teams, we'd have to eliminate some of the other one-loss teams. Like, there'd have to be some upsets. Yeah. Ole Miss could be like Tennessee last year and make the playoff without even winning the division.
Yep. I think this is the year, and it's – coincidentally, the last year of the 14 playoff. I think this is the year where you have the most one-loss teams going, but we should be doing this. We should be. I think this is that year. And then they get out at the end of the season and go, thank God we're not doing that 14 thing anymore. Thank God that was our last trip around the sun, because there's just so much parity right now. Between all of those, I mean, like, if Oklahoma and Georgia played on a neutral site today, I'm not going to put my foot down and say Georgia whips them. I don't believe that. I don't think that Georgia would just walk in and whip Oklahoma today. Like, I don't think of those top 10 teams right now on a neutral site now, I don't think that there's just an answer. Texas, you know, Ohio State.
Yeah. 5 weeks out, though, how much you want to bet that there will be a clear top four?
There will.
Yeah. We'll be sitting here like,
yeah. We're like, we've run all these scenarios, and it's like, nope, yep.
Yeah, we'll be sitting here the week before Thanksgiving going, well, that cleared itself up pretty quick, you know? Yeah. That escalated quickly. We killed a guy.
All right, time to get out of here. As always, oh my gosh, do you remember the movie Good Burger? There's a Good Burger 2 coming out.
Praise God.
Welcome to Good Burger.
God be
praised. Thank you, order.
God be praised.
Hale McGranahan joins us tomorrow, as does the golden tones of Mike Morgan. Thanks to Pat DiMarco and John Whittle for both joining us today on our program. Built by the BarnDominiumCo.com, where you'll build your dream home for as low as $160 per square foot, and part of the Chief Sports Network. Inside the Gamecocks, the show. We'll be back tomorrow at 11, and we'll see you then.